The next item of business is a debate on motion 1248 in the name of Shona Robison on a land of opportunity supporting a fairer and more equal society. I would invite members who want to participate in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or put an R in the chat function if they're joining us remotely. And I call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and move the motion around 15 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'll move the motion in my name at the start. I'm pleased to open this debate to outline the action this government is taking to create a fairer, more equal society for all who live here. We are well aware of the challenges ahead. We know COVID-19 has not gone away, and we must be vigilant whilst the virus remains part of our daily lives. Its impact has been far-reaching, with disproportionate impacts being felt by certain communities and low-income households in particular. We face the double whammy of Brexit too, with rising prices, shortages and a particular toll being faced by many industries. So, as we rebuild from the pandemic, we have an opportunity to ground our recovery in changes that will create a more equal and inclusive society, which is green and fair. By building on our national mission to tackle child poverty, supporting thriving communities, providing people with a safe, warm place to call home, and delivering fair jobs, we will create a land of opportunity for everyone. Last week, the First Minister set out our plans to deliver that vision over this Parliament, and we will work across party lines to do so. The recent agreement with our Scottish Green Party colleagues exemplifies our determination to come together to make Scotland a greener, fairer country, and I welcome having a new minister responsible for delivering a new deal for tenants. Presiding Officer, our goals are clear and we are building on the work of the previous governments and the unprecedented action already taken to achieve them. We've already done so much in our delivery of affordable homes, action on isolation and loneliness, funding to those that help women and girls who are victims of abuse and violence, and tackling child poverty and the poverty-related attainment gap, to name but a few. We're working hard to make sure opportunity is never limited by economic or social background. Let me turn first to a policy area which creates jobs and boosts our economy, and that's housing. We know that housing is pivotal to our recovery and our goal of a fairer, more equal society, as well as reaching our net zero and child poverty targets. Through our long-term housing to 2040 strategy, we have an opportunity to ensure our actions are guided by principles, the principles of social justice, equality and human rights. A strong supply of affordable homes is crucial to that aim. Since 2007, the Scottish Government has delivered over 103,000 affordable homes. Our Housing to 2040 ambition is to deliver a further 110,000 energy-efficient affordable homes by 2032. This would support a total investment package of £18 billion and up to 15,000 jobs each year. Yes.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the SNP government's attempts so far to scale up Housing First have been a failure?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I totally reject that. Housing First has been a success, helping those with additional needs, particularly with addiction, to remain in a stable tenancy with the wraparound support that they need. And if the member paid any attention, he would know that Housing First is a success and is going from strength to strength. I'll come back later. I want to make some progress. At least 70% of the affordable homes will be for social rent, and at least 10% will be in our remote rural and island communities. With over 4,800 homes delivered in the 4 years to 2019-20 in rural areas, we know we are reaching across Scotland, but we want to go further, developing a remote rural and islands housing action plan backed by at least £45 million over this Parliament to ensure that we meet the needs of those communities. This government has already introduced sweeping changes to the private rental sector, protecting tenants and improving standards, and now we'll go further. We'll publish a new rented sector strategy to improve accessibility, affordability and standards across the whole sector and deliver a new deal for tenants. We'll introduce a new housing regulator for the private rented sector to improve standards and ensure fairness. We'll also build on the success in preventing evictions during the pandemic, supporting our aim for everyone to have a safe, warm, affordable home that meets their needs. This includes introducing new restrictions to evictions in winter when people are most vulnerable, and support services that are not readily available. And we'll introduce a new homelessness prevention duty on relevant statutory bodies. Presiding Officer, the right to a home is a human right, as is social security. We're creating a social security system that enshrines that principle. In July, we successfully introduced the pilot of our first major disability benefit, the child disability payment, with national rollout due to start on the 22nd of November. We'll begin shortly transferring the awards of Scottish clients currently in receipt of disability living allowance for children onto our new Scottish benefit. The first time we will undertake the complex transfer of cases from one government to another. Yes.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking this intervention. Can she outline whether or not she's concerned at the costs around setting up Social Security Scotland? They've now doubled, and we're now looking at 2022, £100 million being spent on staff to deliver just £386 million of additional benefits. What work is the government doing to look at these cost overruns?
Cabinet Secretary.
They're not cost overruns. We've already introduced 11 benefits, and we are, when fully operational, Social Security Scotland will administer 17 benefits in total. It is a growing organisation delivering more benefits, and indeed the administration costs will be no higher than those of the DWP when that process is complete. And the member should recognise that that is an important employer. In my home city of Dundee and in Glasgow, employing people quite often furthest from the labour market. I'll take a brief intervention from Pam Duncan Glancy.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you. It's on the transfer of disability benefits and carers' benefits that you mentioned. And we're consistently told that if we were to address eligibility and adequacy for them any sooner than 2025, the capacity in the system would overrun. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us whether or not we need to look now at resources and capacity within Social Security Scotland? Can she also outline why, if the system is going to be so much better in the way that it's delivered in Scotland, why you expect it to be delivered in the same way at the same cost as the DWP?
Cabinet Secretary, I can give you some time back.
Okay, thank you. Well, first of all, the system will be delivered better, far more personal, with at the moment local teams supporting families to apply for the child disability payment. Very much an encouraging a system that encourages and supports people to apply for the benefit. Now, Pam Duncan Glancy will be well aware of the need for a safe and secure transfer of adult disability benefits, but then we're committed for a review once a year down the line that the benefit has been in place. She will understand the complexities of doing that, the potential complexities and knock-on to passporting benefits, something that I'm sure we'll be able to discuss in more detail when I appear in front of the Social Security Committee, because it is a really important issue. The adult disability payment will follow replacing the DWP's personal independence payment with a pilot in the spring of 2022 and full rollout by summer. We're aware of the impact that the pandemic has had on unpaid carers in Scotland and are grateful for their vital contribution. We'll make a further payment of the coronavirus carers allowance supplement this December should the carers allowance supplement bill pass. During this Parliament, we'll also introduce our new Scottish carers assistance. We're continuing to work with carers about ways that support can be improved, and we'll consult on proposals this winter. We'll also introduce our new low-income winter heating assistance to replace the current cold weather payment. This will provide around 400,000 low-income households with a stable annual £50 to help with their winter fuel bills, and will take responsibility for the annual winter fuel payment to those of pension age, currently provided to more than a million Scottish recipients each year, delivering it on the same basis to provide continuity for clients. Presiding Officer, my portfolio covers many areas that will change lives. One of these is human rights, and I'm delighted that Scotland remains a global leader in this area. This year, we'll see us consult on a human rights bill for Scotland, incorporating four UN human rights treaties into Scots law as far as possible within devolved competence. Over the next year, we'll also take forward two other consultations, one on an ambitious strategy to improve how we centre equality, inclusion and human rights in all government policies, decisions and spending, and support the wider public sector and others to do likewise, and the other on the operation of the public sector equality duty and the potential regulatory changes to improve inclusive communications and data on ethnicity and disability pay gaps. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to make some progress. In this government's first 100 days, we allocated an additional £5 million to support frontline organisations which tackle domestic abuse and sexual violence. We will invest over £100 million to support frontline services and ensure dedicated resources to prevent violence against women and girls and to advance gender equality. Our Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group will identify good practice and review and develop new resources. Following the conclusion of that work, alongside looking at harmful sexual behaviour, we will commission an independent review to establish positive practice and further areas for improvement this parliamentary term. I want now to turn to the important area of our national mission on child poverty. In 2020-21, we invested around £2.5 billion to support low-income households, including nearly £1 billion to directly support children, and we'll see this level of support continue. Our actions in the programme for government are wide-ranging, reflecting the fact that it's a package of measures that can tackle poverty, not one alone. This includes supporting more parents into work, expanding free early learning and childcare to 1- and 2-year-olds, and building a system of wraparound school-age childcare to increase households' income and reduce their costs. Education is the right of every child, and we're taking action to reduce the cost of the school day and ensure children can access the subjects and opportunities they want, regardless of family income. We're also committed to a £1 billion investment to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap and support education recovery. From next August, we'll deliver free school meals and milk for all primary pupils, having already introduced the Scottish Milk and Healthy Snack Scheme for children in preschool. We met our commitment to increase the value of Best Start foods in our first 100 days and will expand eligibility in this Parliament, benefiting 60,000 more children. I'll let you in a minute. We'll publish our second Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan next March, setting out ambitious actions to deliver at the pace and scale required to reach our child poverty targets. The plan will be backed by a further £50 million Tackling Child Poverty Fund. I'll give way.
Stephen Kerr.
Grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does the Cabinet Secretary have any concerns about the quality of the meals that we're serving to children in schools? I have had many representations from parents and indeed teachers who are concerned about just how appealing, how attractive, how digestible even some of the meals are because of the way that they're being pre-prepared, frozen, heated up, delivered. It's sometimes not very appetising.
Okay.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah. Well, there are standards and it's very important that all authorities meet those standards. And if there's particular concerns the member has of a particular authority, then he should write to the Cabinet Secretary to, with more detail. In the teeth of this pandemic, we still delivered our groundbreaking Scottish child payment. The most ambitious child poverty reduction measure anywhere in the UK. It's now supporting 105,000 children under six, part of an overall significant package of financial support that sees low-income families receive over £5,300 in the early years of a child's life. And of course, there's more to come. If the DWP provide the data we need to our timescales, then we will deliver the payment to under-16s by the end of 2022. A game-changing payment that, even at its current value, could reach up to 392,000 children and reduce child poverty by an estimated 2 percentage points in 2023-24. To provide immediate support to families, we are delivering bridging payments for children in receipt of free school meals, providing £520 a year for around 148,000 children £200 of that has already been paid, with £160 to be paid in October and December. My party's manifesto committed to double the Scottish Child Payment to £20 in this parliamentary term. That is four times the amount originally called for to tackle child poverty. We want and will do this as soon as possible. As the First Minister set out last week, this is a significant investment and it will be part of our budget process later this year. We will set out our plans on the budget bill shortly ahead of our next Tackling Child Poverty plan. Clear action to tackle child poverty, designed to lift people out of poverty, yet it is in the face of the actions of another government who hold the levers of around 85% of welfare spending and has taken no action to tackle child poverty since its election 11 years ago. Whilst we take action, the positive action I have laid out today, we look at the UK government and their fixation with austerity and the many changes to welfare politics which have contributed to poverty, with another one round the corner. The Tories quite often talk about Scotland having two governments. One government is aiming to double the Scottish Child Payment. The other is going to take £20 a week out of the pockets of low-income households. That will happen shortly unless there is a complete change, and that will be a scandal that we've not seen in over 70 years. Over 6 million households across the UK will lose over £1,000 a year, many of those unable to work due to ill health, disability or caring responsibilities, and for many others in work but needing to rely on universal credit to make ends meet. These issues have been raised by campaigners, they've been raised by every devolved government. They've ignored four Social Security committees of the UK nations who joined together to stand up for the people they represent. They've ignored their own backbenchers, none from Scottish constituencies who were posted missing, I may add. They've ignored a former DWP Secretary of State. They've ignored their own government official, one of whom is quoted as saying, "The internal modelling of ending the universal credit uplift is catastrophic. Homelessness and poverty are likely to rise and food bank usage will soar. It could be a real disaster of the autumn." So, Presiding Officer, today is an opportunity for all of us to lay out what we're going to do to tackle child poverty and make Scotland a fairer nation. I look forward to working with people across this chamber in order to do so.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move Amendment 1248.1. Mr. Briggs, around 11 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And as the Cabinet Secretary started her speech, I too would like to start my speech today by saying that this session of Parliament, I hope we can find agreement where possible and consensus on a number of issues and areas of work to address poverty and inequality in Scotland. At the election, there was genuine cross-party commitment to work to tackle child poverty and, as the motion suggests, to make that a national mission. And indeed, all parties elected to this Parliament agreed to double the child payment and work to meet the targets to reduce child poverty. Scottish Conservatives supported the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment and have continued to support and press for reforms. That's why my amendment for today's debate calls on Parliament to support the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment within this next financial year, something all charities and stakeholders providing useful briefings for this debate have called for MSPs to support. The negative impact which the pandemic has had on Scotland's children and young people is only just starting to be fully understood. But for the most vulnerable children and young people in our society, we know the impact has been significant. Realising the potential of every child and young person in Scotland is something we all agree must be a key focus of this Parliament and the SNP Green Coalition Scottish Government. And the hard work that will take to meet the... Can I make some progress and I'll bring you back in? The hard work it will take to meet these ambitious targets as set out in the 2017 Child Poverty Bill is something we all must work to do. Remember?
Bob Doris.
I thank the member for giving way. With this complete humility that I asked this question, how on earth can you stand there with any credibility or dignity and say you're concerned about vulnerable
Not
children?
Not you, Mr.
When,
Doris.
When the member is going to rob those vulnerable families of £20 per week. the most impoverished families that are already on the breadline and recourse to food banks. How can you look anyone in the eyes and say that you're helping those vulnerable children? It's an absolute disgrace.
Through the chair, please, Mr. Doris. Miles Briggs.
Well, the member will be aware that I'm on record supporting the extension, but I note the Scottish Government's amendment for this debate doesn't include any mention of the issue. What is on the table, though, today is my amendment calling for the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment within this financial year. Will the member be supporting my amendment this evening?
No.
So the member seems to have lost his voice on this issue, but I'd respectfully suggest to SNP and Green members that they get their house in order when they come to this chamber to ask of things of opposition members as well. Now, one of the areas I believe urgent action is needed is long-term impact on the lockdown has had on children's learning, and we heard this at Education Questions just previously. Long-term system-wide support is required if every child is to have a catch-up and recovery from the educational disruption which we've seen during the pandemic and the impact that's had on child development across Scotland. Prior to the pandemic, we know SNP ministers were failing to close the educational attainment gap, and indeed the Audit Scotland report released in March of this year exposed the lack of progress that's been made in closing the poverty-relating attainment gap as well. That's why Scottish Conservatives want to see the Scottish Government focus more on prioritising young people's education with the delivery of additional support for catch-up schemes for disadvantaged children and young people. It's also important, I believe, to consider the skills and training opportunities available for young people to find work in key growth sectors. The loss of over 100,000 college training places under this SNP government has clearly impacted on the number of opportunities available for young people. But making sure that young people in Scotland who are not in training or education have the opportunities to access a number of schemes and apprenticeships, for example, is critical and something we all need to work to make happen. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to take this opportunity, as I did on Tuesday's debate around renewing, remobilising and recovering the social care and health service of Scotland, to specifically thank and highlight the contribution made by unpaid carers and especially young carers in Scotland during the pandemic. The pandemic has significantly increased the number of unpaid carers across our country. Research in June 2020 showed that 392,000 more people have become unpaid carers, taking the total to over 1.1 million of our fellow Scots now taking on a caring role for a family member. It's now estimated that 45,000 young people are now carers across Scotland. Undertaking a caring role is a key contributing factor linked to poverty. Whether they're a paid carer or whether they're an unpaid carer, you're more likely to live in poverty as a result. Now, given the importance of care to people, our society, and the invaluable contribution unpaid carers make, this cannot be right. The pandemic has exposed the extent to which our NHS and social care services rely on unpaid carers. Now, Scottish Conservatives welcome the doubling of the carers allowance supplement, and we on these benches want to see more progress on how we can support Scotland's carers, especially our young carers. Scottish Conservatives also support early action to extend payments for carers after a bereavement, and for a new support package for carers who've often had to give up work to care for a loved one. We also want to see help to access training and more mental health support. And I also hope ministers will work with the Scottish Conservatives to seriously consider reforms as soon as possible around the Young Carers Grant and reforms to entitlement to allow younger carers to qualify for the carers allowance supplement. And for care-experienced young Scots, we need to make sure a real focus remains from this government on improving access to services, transition and care. The recommendations of the Independent Care Review were widely supported across this Parliament, but we've seen little progress from ministers to implement the promise and for a national minimum allowance for foster carers, as has been previously committed and is in place in other parts of the UK. My colleague, Megan Gallagher, will outline more on this important issue later, but care-experienced young people expect to see promises made by ministers kept and action to take forward the implementation and implement recommendations of that review. Turning, in the time I have left, to the critical issue of housing and homelessness, the number of children in temporary accommodation has reached the highest level on record before the pandemic. At the end of March 2020, there were 7,280 children living in temporary accommodation due to homelessness. This is the highest since records began in 2002 and represents a 7% increase on the previous year. In the year leading up to the pandemic, someone was made homeless every 17 minutes in Scotland. Now, we know that the number of people and families in temporary accommodation has increased over the course of the pandemic. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to the member, he raises an important point, and we're working with local authorities to tackle the issue around temporary accommodation as a matter of urgency and providing £37.5 million to do so. But can he genuinely answer the question whether he thinks that the £20 cut to universal credit is going to help or hinder the number of people in temporary accommodation? Does he think it will put more people into temporary accommodation or less people?
Well, the support provided and the reforms we've seen have been to try to prevent that very issue. And I welcome the steps which local authorities have provided during to provide emergency accommodation during the pandemic. But we now need to see a long-term plan to end homelessness, something for 14 years SNP ministers have failed to do. Rough sleeping needs to see, and homelessness needs to see, a system-wide shift towards a preventative model. And I agree with the Cabinet Secretary and hope that there is genuinely an opportunity for us to look at that. Because SNP ministers pledged to tackle homelessness by scaling up Housing First, as my colleague Stephen Kerr mentioned. But we've missed previous targets supporting 800 people into Housing First tenancies. In fact, the 2021-22 programme for government states ministers will invest in the new Housing Homelessness Together Fund, funding rapid rehousing and support of scaling up Housing First. But we know the Pathfinder total number of people moving into their own home through this project, through Housing First, has stated only 381 people actually entered secure tenancies by the end of November in 2020, not 800, Cabinet Secretary. So we know there has to be improvement from this government. There's a huge amount of work to do. And as Crisis Scotland stated in their useful briefing ahead of today's debate, ending homelessness does not just mean that nobody will ever lose their home again. It means that we need to make sure that we go to a preventative model. Homelessness only happens where homelessness will only happen very rarely. At present, around 8% of the Scottish population, or 1 in 12 people, has experienced homelessness. Now, I very much support the calls for this preventative model to be brought forward, and we will work with ministers where we can to make sure that that can be achieved. Because action to prevent homelessness should start 6 months before someone faces losing their home. Public bodies such as health services should be asking about people's housing situations to try to identify issues earlier. Now, the recommendations which I know have been set out to ministers around the preventative, the homeless preventative group, I hope these will also be now taken forward. These recommendations were supported by every party across Parliament, and the discussions which I've already had with the Cabinet Secretary, I hope, can make sure that we make this a national priority. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I know my time's running out, it's clear that we need to see cross-portfolio efforts now to make progress in addressing poverty and achieving specific reductions across the board, and to meet the targets we all supported. There are also longer-term issues that we as a Parliament, I believe, need to start to consider if we're going to bring about real change. Action to address intergenerational unemployment, opportunities to genuinely improve social mobility. As I said at the start of my contribution, I hope this Parliament can find agreement where possible and consensus on a number of issues and areas of work so that we all can be proud in 5 years that we've put in the effort to tackle poverty and inequality in Scotland. And I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Briggs. I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to and move Amendment 1248.2. Ms Duncan-Glancy, you have around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And before I move on to the substantial words that I prepared in advance of today, I just want to say that people watching this debate and people looking at what's happening across both parliaments and both governments outside who are living in poverty right now are seriously needing you both to get your act together. Because actually, we've got a situation where the £20 uplift that was given during the pandemic in recognition of the fact that social security was at its worst in decades cannot be taken away. It will leave people in destitution. But the Scottish Government can't sit on their hands either and point fingers. We're at a situation where you're using the Scottish Government are using the same arguments to not roll out payments to under 16-year-olds that the DWP used to not give the £20 uplift to legacy benefits. They're claiming it's logistically difficult and the IT systems aren't there. So people out there really need us both to get our act together and get moving on this before poverty is a part of more people's lives. I will.
We are not dragging our feet, which is why, of course, we're delivering that through bridging payments while these very issues are resolved. Surely the member will recognise that important aspect of the Scottish Government's delivery in order to get the money into people's hands.
Ms Duncan Glancy, I can give you back the time too.
Thank you, and thank you for that. And I do recognise that, but 125,000 children who should get the payments under 16-year-olds aren't getting the bridging payments because bridging payments are only paid to people who get free school meals. So there's still 125,000 children out there who should get the money that are not. So as always, I'll move to what I was going to say. As always, it is a great privilege to lead this debate for Scottish Labour. The debate today has been titled A Land of Opportunity, and that is what I believe all of us in this chamber want Scotland to be. Somewhere where no matter who you are, who you love, or where you were born, you can live up to your full potential. Sadly, though, for too many, we're not there yet. As we sit here today, 1 million of our fellow citizens are living in poverty. 260,000 of them are children. We're set to miss the child poverty targets we set ourselves in this Parliament, and without caveat. And half of families living in poverty have a disabled person in them. Disabled people in Scotland are twice as likely when they leave school to not be in education or employment. The disability pay gap remains at 8.3%. Tens of thousands live in homes they can't get in and out of. They don't have the care they need and they're underrepresented everywhere from the high street to the boardroom. And the fact that 6 in 10 people who died from COVID-19 are disabled people shows quite clearly the disproportionate impact that the pandemic has had, but also the chasms that were existing in society before it. Things are not equal for women either. Women are more likely to be in poverty than men, more likely to experience in-work poverty and find it harder to escape poverty than men. Women's work in sectors like care, cleaning, hospitality and retail has long been undervalued, underpaid and underprotected. And the pandemic has meant women are doing more unpaid labour, being forced to carry out more unpaid caring responsibilities, childcare and housework than ever before. It's estimated that a collective £15 million of income has been lost each day in Scotland through the work many women had no choice but to take on. And LGBT plus equality in Scotland is nowhere near where it needs to be either. Stonewall Research has found that almost a quarter of LGBT people have witnessed discrimination and negative remarks against them by healthcare staff, with a startling 37% of trans people avoiding healthcare as a result. 6% of trans employees have been physically attacked by customers or colleagues, and only half of LGBT staff agree that equality policies in their workplace protect trans people. I think I'm quite clearly explaining why those in the groups I've highlighted so far cannot see Scotland as a land of opportunity right now.
Miles Brooks.
Taken. The number of homeless deaths in Scotland rose by nearly a third over 2 years. And can I ask, would she support my calls for the government to have a full review of access to healthcare for homeless people and rough sleepers, especially given the drug deaths that we've seen?
Ms Duncan Glancy.
Thank you. Thank you for your intervention. I think the drug deaths show and the homelessness shows that we really need to seriously take homelessness and healthcare for homeless people very seriously. I think we heard a statistic this morning that if you're homeless, you're more likely to die in your late 30s. That's your life expectancy. So there is absolutely an urgent need to look at healthcare for people who are homeless. People from ethnic minority backgrounds in Scotland are also 20% more likely to be out of work. Of all the people reporting that they had experienced harassment, 19% were from black minority and ethnic backgrounds, the highest of any one group. People from black minority ethnic backgrounds also still face disproportionately higher rates of poverty. So I say again, that Scotland is not a land of opportunity for these people. Thousands are held back by poverty and inequality, denied their rights and their potential. This past year has been tough for every one of us, the hardest I believe most of us have had. The pandemic has meant people have been unable to leave their homes, travel to see friends, family, unable to go to shops and do things they enjoy. And none of us have enjoyed living like that. But women, people in poverty, disabled people, people from black minority ethnic backgrounds and LGBT plus people have faced restrictions on their human rights and freedoms like this for years. They've tried their best, knocked their pan in and yet still struggle to make ends meet and still face barriers at every turn. They've been overlooked and undervalued. They've needed more affordable homes, a crackdown on unscrupulous landlords and a pay rise for years. And whilst this year has been dreadful for so many people, things were hard before COVID. Poverty was rife, insecure and precarious work was too common, social care was creaking at the seams, and inequality was holding us back then. Things were bad before. The pandemic has made it worse. All is not equal, and all never was equal. But this last year has shone some light in dark corners. One such corner was the inadequacy of the social security system, which led to the £20 uplift to universal credit. Cutting that now is abhorrent and will be devastating. The UK government must do the right thing and keep the uplift. And the Scottish government must act too. They must find a way to ensure that the 4,000 families set to lose eligibility for the Scottish Child Payment as a result of the cut to universal credit retain that eligibility. I believe we must see now, all of us, that the opportunities we want for our family, friends and country are not there. And I believe we all have to act. But, Presiding Officer, we do have a reason to be hopeful. These past months have been difficult for everyone, and it's forced us to work together in new ways and think about doing things differently. So as we go forward and begin our journey for recovery, we do have an opportunity to take the lessons and do things differently. From hardship and pain does come strength and hunger for change. But that will need bold, transformative change to ensure that things don't go back to the way they were. We need to include everyone on our journey and make sure that things are better for everyone than they were before. That's why I continue to be hungry for more ambition and bold action from the SNP Green Programme for Government. It's also why I'm disappointed that it lacks urgency, innovation and real action to change lives now. The Scottish Government can and should be using all the powers it has to radically transform lives. Crucially, though, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Government must act on its mission to end poverty. Declaration is not enough. It will not put food on tables. We're at a unique point in our history where we have an opportunity to rebuild our social security system from the ground up. And so far, change has been incremental. The system is at risk of failing to live up to the hopes that it would be a radically fairer system. We know that a well-designed, properly funded social security system can tackle poverty and reduce economic, health and education inequalities. And it's time for radical investment into Scotland's social security system. That's a statement I believe many share, and I know it has the support for some in government because it comes from the Scottish Greens manifesto on social security. So I look to my colleagues in the Green Party and ask them to please work with us in the Labour Party, support our calls, stand by the commitments, and take this opportunity to encourage your government colleagues to be radical. Presiding Officer, I cannot mask my frustration that the government is failing to meet the moment in front of us and seize the opportunity to be radical as it builds a new system. One that must be adequate, dignified, accessible and automated where possible. And we're happy to support much of the government motion today, but not the lack of ambition in this regard. We're not yet using our powers to their full potential. We need to quickly address eligibility for and adequacy of carers and disability payments. Waiting until 2025 is too long. That's both time and opportunity lost. We have to go harder and faster. We urge the government to back our amendment. Do this to accelerate an ambitious and urgent timetable for transformation. That's why the amendment we've put forward focuses on action we can take right now. Doubling the Scottish Child Payment and adding £5 for families with a disabled person in them would help protect them from poverty. That's why we're calling on the government to immediately increase the payment to £20 a week. But that isn't going to be far enough for us to meet our targets. We know that despite the government's current commitment, we're going to miss them. That's why we're calling for the government to double the Scottish Child Payment now and again in a year, lifting 50,000 children out of poverty and put us on track to meet the 2023 target. We've heeded the First Minister's calls for a constructive parliament. Where we can work with the government, we will and we have. Today, the government has a chance to work with us to get us back on track on child poverty in Scotland by backing our amendment and calls from charities across Scotland. Deputy Presiding Officer, one person held back by inequality or overlooked by discrimination is one too many. One child in poverty is one too many. One day in poverty is one day too long. As this debate is titled, The Land of Opportunity, I urge the Chamber to seize its opportunity and to act to and open opportunity for thousands of people across Scotland to double the Scottish Child Payment now and again in a year. I urge the Chamber to back our motion. Deputy Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Ms Duncan Glancy. And I now call on Willie Rennie before we move to the open debate. Mr Rennie, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I hope the Ministers were listening to that contribution, because I think that was one of the most powerful contributions that I've heard in the Chamber for some time. And there was a lot to learn from Pam Duncan Glancy. That was an encyclopaedia of information about the state of poverty in Scotland. And I think ministers should listen, but more importantly, they should act as well. I want to focus my contribution on child poverty. Eradicating child poverty is an urgent mission. After 30 years of decline across the UK, it is once again on the rise. That means more than one in four, 260,000 Scottish children are officially recognised as living in poverty. In absence of significant policy change, this figure is likely to increase in the coming years, reaching 38% in 10 years. The Resolution Foundation suggests that Scottish child poverty rate will be 29% in 2 years. Lots of numbers, but let me clarify for you. 25% now. In 2 years, it will rise to 29%. And in 10 years, to 38%. That should be our shame. If we do nothing, and what we're doing so far is just not enough. The connection between poverty and poor educational outcomes, behavioural problems, chronic illness and mental health are clearly evidenced. I'm going to come to the Conservative government later on universal credit, but every parliament in the UK needs to work to address the poverty gripping too many of our children. Not just to complain about another government, but to take action on areas within our power. And I'm afraid this government too often points the finger elsewhere rather than taking action here at home. For Liberals, education and work is the route out of poverty. We support putting power in the hands of young people by giving them the educational tools they need to achieve. Get a good job and a warm home for them and their family in future. And the performance in Scotland has just not been good enough. 5 years ago, the First Minister promised to close the poverty-related attainment gap completely. She said it was simply unacceptable that youngsters from the most deprived areas of Scotland only do half as well as their counterparts from the richest areas when sitting higher exams. And this is what she said precisely. I want our work to close the attainment gap to be the mission, not just of this government or even of this parliament, but of the whole of the country. Yet over 5 years later, the poverty-related attainment gap still stands at 35.8 points of a difference at the SCQF level 6 or above. At that rate of progress, and I acknowledge there has been some modest progress, but at that rate of progress, it will take another 35 years for the poverty-related attainment gap to close. That's what the First Minister promised, to close completely. She didn't say it will take 35 years. And this is an area of public policy completely in the hands of the Scottish Government. This Government has talked a good game on education and poverty, but has failed to deliver. It has been slow-footed on introducing early years education for two-year-olds. And it's still slow-footed. Only about a third of those two-year-olds that are entitled to the nursery education access it. And that's been going on for years, yet the Government have failed to take the action. It's been slow-footed on adopting the pupil premium in England that targets funds to the poorest pupils in school. The not-made-in-here belligerence of the SNP has had a dramatic impact on the life chances of thousands of young people. The clock is ticking for this SNP Green Coalition Government, because the clock is ticking for our young people as well. A poor child starting school now will be 40 years old by the time this coalition government closes the poverty-related attainment gap. But they deserve so much more than this. I want to turn to the Conservatives. Modest criticism from the Conservative benches here is just not enough. I happen to agree with the Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, when he declared that the best way to take people out of poverty is to find them high-quality work. Who could disagree with that? That also happens to be the best way of cutting the cost of universal credit to the public purse. High-quality work cuts the universal credit not by £20, by £100. Yet the Conservatives have an unhealthy belief that the best way to tackle poverty is to make those who can't find work, well-paid work, because that's what it would require, the response from the government is to make them even poorer than they are now. That's not the way to tackle poverty. That's not the way to get people into work. And the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, they were very clear about this. They said it could force 500,000 people, almost half of them children, into poverty. The Scottish Conservatives need to speak up and make their voice heard. If they don't agree with this, let them speak and let them criticise the government and let them force the government into taking action. Because the Conservatives have been cavalier on this. It is no longer acceptable. It's short-sighted, it's cruel and it's mean-spirited to punish people who are in their hour of need. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call Neil Gray, who will be followed by Pam Gosal. Around 6 minutes, Mr. Gray, but we've got a bit of time in hand, so for interventions, we can recompense you.
The fellow Arcadian knows how this one likes to talk. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm really pleased to be speaking in favour of the motion today, as it really highlights the ambition this Scottish Government has for the session ahead. And I note from the amendments today, particularly the Labour amendment, that there is actually quite considerable consensus, even if it is tacit, across the chamber for the measures being brought forward by the Scottish Government. So it's perhaps a wee bit contrary for Anna Sarwar and so many of his Labour colleagues since the programme for government was announced to say it somehow lacked ambition, when the areas mentioned in the motion today go further or match the Labour manifesto commitments, and so little is being sought from the amendment. Indeed, the one area of real deviation, I'll probably answer this in my next paragraph, indeed the one area of real deviation from what is set out in the programme for government and the opposition amendment today is on the Scottish Child Payment. Now, all payments, all parties went into the election promising to double the Scottish Government's anti-poverty, game-changing Scottish Child Payment. And for someone as an anti-poverty campaigner who believes building consensus drives and sustains progress, that was incredibly heartening for me. The question mark is, of course, around timing. We all want to see this happening as quickly as possible, but this highlights the limitations of a hybrid tax and social security system. The Scottish Child Payment is demand-led, meaning the budget commitments will change year on year depending on eligibility. And of course, when eligibility is at higher times of higher unemployment or poor economic performance, which suppresses wages, so there is also the time when the consequential tax receipts are also lower. So when you need to fund more social security, your revenue is reduced, and that is why demand-led social security requires borrowing to work. This Parliament doesn't have the adequate borrowing powers, which means it takes longer to safely deliver and sustain social security benefits than if it was being delivered with the full powers. I'll take Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Sorry, I thought we were going to my colleague, Mike O'Mara. The point I was going to make was around the point about ambition. Our amendment to the motion absolutely recognises the work that is ongoing, but consistently with the evidence we heard this morning in the Social Security Committee that I know the member will have heard too, the social security system is going to have to do the heavy lifting, and that's where we need to put our energies in order to lift children out of poverty and families out of poverty. Would the member agree that that's the single biggest thing that we need to do right now?
Yes, and obviously we are in a tale of two governments, with one government that's investing in social security, one that is cutting social security. But also I note, and I'm going to come to this, neither Labour nor the Tories included the Scottish Child Payment commitments they're making in their amendments today in their manifestos, which was the point that I was going to come in on with Miles Briggs. So I'm looking forward to seeing their costed budget submissions coming up. It would lack any credibility for either party to make these demands, which go beyond their just four-month-old manifestos, without explaining how they should be paid for. We have to operate within a fixed budget in Holyrood, so new spending commitments have to be met from existing resources, as we don't have the necessary borrowing powers like a normal parliament delivering social security. But the investment, by all means.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank the member for taking the intervention. I'm slightly confused by this line of argument. because all social security benefits are demand-led. And yet, this government has been very happy to take on PIP, take on DLA, which again will go up at different times. How are we going to pay for those?
My point is that the commitments that are being made are being forecast and budgeted ahead of time. So this is exactly the same point that's been made around the Scottish Child Payment. For this to happen properly, it needs to be done in a way that ensures the budget safety is built in over time, which is why the points that have been made by the two opposition parties, they need to come forward with where they would make the cuts in order to deliver the commitments that they are making. But the investment that has been budgeted for in this session by the Scottish Government to make real improvements to our social infrastructure will make a real difference to people's lives across Airdrie and Shotts and across Scotland. Expanding our childcare offer to 1- and 2-year-olds, investing £1 billion to tackle the poverty-related educational attainment gap, and I must declare an interest as my wife is a primary school teacher and soon take up a role as a local authority equity development officer. Expanding wraparound childcare, doubling the Scottish top-up to carers' allowance so that carers in Scotland will receive better support than anywhere else in these Isles. Doubling the Scottish Child Payment and providing bridging payments as the rollout to 16-year-old continues, providing new adult and child disability payments, building 100,000 new affordable homes, including 70% for social rent, and expanding free school meals and increasing school uniform grants. Now, I could go on, Presiding Officer. This government is investing in social security, investing in social housing and investing in education, all to tackle poverty, give our children the best start in life, to support families and develop the progressive and compassionate society that delivers for the people we are here to represent. But I spoke earlier about Scotland having a hybrid social security system, partly devolved. And sadly, we are seeing a tale of two governments. At a time when UK inflation is at its highest level in a decade, with the sharpest rise in inflation since records began, and when it is predicted to keep rising into Christmas, meaning the cost of essential items are rising and family budgets are squeezed, the UK government is embarking on a perfect storm of tax rises and social security cuts that will devastate those on the lowest incomes. We have the regressive 10% rise to national insurance coming, which will disproportionately hit younger workers and the lowest paid. We have the disgraceful cut to universal credit, the biggest single cut to social security since the Second World War. It will force 60,000 people in Scotland into poverty, including 20,000 children. That will completely undermine the benefit of the Scottish Child Payment and serves to highlight the real limitations of having a shared or hybrid social security system. In Airdrie and Shotts alone, 10,500 people who receive universal credit or working tax credits and their families will see their annual income cut by £1,000. Now, we have already heard from the Cabinet Secretary the quote in the Financial Times from last week that the internal modelling of ending the UK UC uplift is catastrophic. So regressive tax rises and cuts to social security while inflation soars from the UK government versus investment in social security, investment in social housing and investment in education from the Scottish government. The Tories have got a real brass neck coming here and trying to lecture us about poverty. So I support this motion, I support the government's programme and I look forward to those transformational poverties within it being delivered at pace.
Thank you, Mr Gray. I now call Pam Gosell, who will be followed by Emma Roddick. Ms Gosell, again, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Social justice, social security, welfare, whatever name you want to give it, it's the most important responsibility for any government. Today's debate is a useful reminder that far more needs to be done to tackle poverty in Scotland and ensure everyone can live their lives to the fullest in a fair society. Presiding Officer, we should spend all day we can debating our thoughts on how Scotland can be a fairer country. But when we look at the main levers that help create a fairer society, better healthcare, a good education system, stable employment and affordable housing, let's be honest, these are hardly the areas that the SNP excel on. Organisations... If I get the time back, I'm happy. Yeah.
Cabinet Secretary.
So if you're saying that if the member is saying that the Scottish Government doesn't excel on affordable housing and we've delivered the over 103,000 affordable homes so far, that is 75% more per head of the population than the affordable homes delivered in England by a Tory government. What does that say about the Tory government's record on affordable housing?
Pam Gosell.
Cabinet Member, thank you very much for your observation, but here we're actually talking about Scotland. All we keep hearing is about, today I've heard in this chamber, is about the United Kingdom, or if it's not about England, let's compare it. But I'm going to be honest, you're talking about homes here, right? No, if you let me finish, please, if you're talking about homes here, right, why is there so much homelessness if you're doing such a great job over there? That's what I want to know. Anyway, I need to get on with my speech now. Organisations such as Barnettas and Save the Children have said, even before the pandemic struck, one in four children in Scotland were living in poverty, and the levels were rising in every local authority in Scotland. The attainment gap remains very wide. We cannot continue with this postcode lottery, where pupils from the most deprived areas do significantly worse at every level of education on an average than those in the least deprived areas. To give you some home truths, I want to talk about my own region. We have a tale of two towns, Milngavie and Clydebank, only minutes away but worlds apart. One where schools rank 14th out of 340 schools, and one where schools rank 230th. One where 68% pupils leave with five hires, and one where only 33% leave with five hires. Moving on from two towns, we look at the bigger picture of my whole region, on Western Bartonshire. There's almost double the national average of homeless households per 100,000 people. People can expect to fall into ill health over 10 years before their neighbours in Eastern Bartonshire, where the number of children that go on to positive destinations has seen drops of almost 4% on the previous year. Presiding Officer, let me be clear. If those figures don't leave you questioning the Scottish Government's priorities, then I don't know what will. Now, I am sure this will be a familiar story for many MSPs in this chamber today. It is sadly a situation that is reflected across the country, but these aren't just statistics. They're real people, and they matter. Let me tell you how the story goes with welfare, which, by the way, for those of you who don't know, 11 benefits were devolved to the Scotland in 2016, meaning that the Scottish Government are in charge of those. Yes, the Scottish Government, not Westminster. But no surprise, the SNP were not ready and had to hand back the powers to DWP. And all this from a party that said they could set up an independent Scotland in just 18 months, but won't have finished taking the devolved welfare powers until 2025. If we're going to be serious in making Scotland a fairer society, then we need to start thinking long-term. Not what the SNP are doing today, which is sticking plasters over the cracks. Scotland needs much more. People need real change. The motion today calls on doubling of the Scottish Child Benefit as early as possible within the current parliamentary session. We support that. In fact, our motion goes further and calls for payment to be doubled within the next financial year.
The member is not giving way.
But it has only taken the SNP 3 years to implement such an important payment. Presiding Officer, I highly doubt there is anyone in this chamber today that doesn't want to see a fairer Scotland. There is real inequality in our society, and that must change. I hope that poverty and inequality will get the full attention of the Scottish Government during this term of the Parliament, not limited to an afterthought with endless reports and policies being published and no real action. We want to build a Scotland which not only supports those in financial crisis, but helps lift people out of poverty for good by tackling the root causes of poverty. We all agree that poverty must be reduced. We all agree that attainment gaps must be tackled. The health, social care must be improved. And the housing should be safe, affordable and warm. We cannot afford to sidetrack by meaningless debates on independence.
Can the member
and
wind
endless
up, please?
False promises not why Scotland's children go hungry. Thank you. Sorry, Presiding Officer, I was told that I would get some extra time. That's why.
Thank you. I call Emma Roddick to be followed by Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like 1 in 12 people in Scotland, I have experience of homelessness, so a programme for government which aims to prevent it is something that I welcome very strongly. Homelessness isn't, or certainly shouldn't be, just a fact of life and something that happens to people in the process of a normal society functioning. It is a symptom of a lot of things, of lack of affordable housing, inadequate social security, a bad attitude towards disabled people, carers and others who are unable to work, and frankly the inability, or more likely indifference, of certain governments. But I am glad to be able to say that that is not the case here. This programme for government seeks to address all of these issues insofar as it can with current devolved powers, although, of course, a true transformation of our society requires the powers of independence. This is the country which ended right to buy. This is the country which declared that anyone unintentionally homeless was entitled to a permanent home. And this will be the country that says, no, actually, people are not going to be homeless in 21st century Scotland. We are going to listen to them, understand the issues that face them, and do what we can to make sure that they have access to a safe and secure home. Something often missing from homelessness action plans is tackling the wider drivers of poverty, so throwing money at tackling homelessness once the person is already homeless. What homelessness actually shows is that someone has fallen through a net. Maybe they've had to wait 6 weeks before they got their first universal credit payment. Maybe they lost their job due to shameful employment rights. Maybe they were failed by a landlord who took advantage of loopholes in a tenancy. I'm therefore glad to see the focus on availability of homes, decarbonising homes, putting money into supporting families with young children in their early years as priorities for this government. I don't think people appreciate just how often poverty is essentially predetermined. We've heard a lot so far today, and I'm sure we're going to hear a lot more about child poverty, and nobody can blame a child for living in poverty in a poor household. But when that child grows up, somewhere around late teens, early 20s, it seems to start becoming okay for people to say that it's that person's fault, that they don't have the same educational background, they don't have money in the bank for a rainy day, they couldn't afford their driving licence when they were 16, or they have poor health due to lifelong nutritional or exercise issues. It's important that we tackle those drivers of poverty. A fairer Scotland is a Scotland which addresses issues at the root, rather than once a person has already had the whole course of their life changed just by being homeless even for a short time. Take it from me, employers, credit agencies, landlords, they do not like to see care of addresses. I'm going to move on a bit to the Tories' amendment today, because I note that it laments the fact that the Scottish Government is not taking full control over devolved benefits until 2025. Now, I agree with that. It is a real shame that it took so long to devolve these powers and that it's taking a couple extra years, pandemic years, to bring social security in properly, something that their party down south hasn't managed in over a decade of power. Yes, what have you got?
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to remember, I appreciate she wasn't here in the last Parliament, but we passed the bill within 18 months of that Parliament. We've now had, it's going to take almost 8 years for this to happen. The delay is not this Parliament, it's the Scottish Government not being able to take the powers and relying on the DWP to do all the work.
Emma Roddick.
Presiding Officer, it's a real shame that my colleagues on those benches have no sense of irony, hypocrisy or shame. When they criticise the Scottish Government for being too slow implementing benefits like the Scottish Child Payment, which was only brought in to mitigate the harm caused by a UK social security system which started out inadequate and then suffered years of cuts. It's a real shame that so much of government budgets in this country are spent trying to stop UK austerity hitting our worst off the hardest, and it's a real shame that the Scottish Government is having to wait another few years before every power is devolved for decisions to be made for this country in this country. But I'm sure in the spirit of their amendment today that my colleagues over there will be delighted when that day finally comes. I'm also grateful to Crisis, the homelessness charity, for drawing my attention yesterday to a number of incredibly pertinent points, including their belief that the current plans this government has to prevent homelessness, which were developed with input from those with lived experience, hold the potential to make Scotland a world leader in homelessness prevention. Now, every time I, as a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, read a paper which discusses homelessness, I am reminded of the process in which my housing officer told me she needed an address in order to process my entry to the housing register, and in which I faced at least 2 years of temporary accommodation before I could imagine walking into a council house that I could call home. Now, whenever we discuss that, poverty or disability benefits which I currently receive, the personal connection is not lost on me, nor is the weight of responsibility. I will always truly value those who offer their lived experience to me and this Parliament to aid our decision-making and improve the lives of others. And I would encourage my colleagues to reflect and do the same and listen to those in poverty.
I call Alex Rowley to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Right now, more than one in four children in Scotland are living in poverty. And as Willie Rennie said earlier, according to analysis by the Resolution Foundation, the Scottish child poverty rate will be 29% by 23-24. The highest rate of child poverty in over 20 years. All of this stands in stark contrast to the fall in child poverty observed in the UK in the 1990s and early 2000s. Labour reforms from 1997 saw £18 billion annual increase in spending on support for families with children and an £11 billion annual increase in support for pensioners by 2010-11. The result was millions of children and pensioners were lifted out of poverty, and the country was on track to eradicate child poverty by 2020. And the key point for mentioning that is that if we are, in the short term, wanting to tackle child poverty and tackle poverty, the evidence is clear. You have to put the resources in, and you must put money in to increase people's spending power. Now, successive Tory governments managed to dismantle those achievements with their failed austerity agenda, and we now have a situation in Scotland, as across the UK, where we have food banks in every city, every town. And for those who have not seen the film I, Daniel Blake, then they should have a look at that film, because it brings home the reality of failure by government to support people when they need that support. The author James Baldwin once said, anyone who has ever struggled with poverty knows how extremely expensive it is to be poor. And that's why I have to say the hypocrisy of the Scottish Tory Party to come along here and talk about child poverty while at the same time supporting a move by the Johnson government to cut £20 a week from universal credit, the largest cut, overnight cut, ever seen since the creation of the welfare state 70 years ago. The hypocrisy is absolutely incredible. And if the Scottish Tories believe that the £20 a week cut to the poorest, the most vulnerable, the lowest paid workers is wrong, then you really need to condemn that cut and stand with the rest of this Parliament in condemning that cut, because it will result in more children in Scotland being in poverty. It will result in more people in Scotland having to go to food banks. And can I say, because the member earlier talked about the independence, Pan Gossel talked about independence, the greatest driver to increase support for independence in Scotland is to drive more and more people in Scotland into poverty by direct action of a Westminster government. So if you cannot see that, then, you know, pretty help us. In terms of other areas, it is true that if we look to the medium term, then we have to get more people into work. We have to get people to be earning a good wage. And I have to say that over the last 14 years, when the SNP came to power, they promised to cut class sizes When I look at primary schools where the Education Secretary represents, and I represent in Fife, the number of primary classes in Fife with over 30, some 32, 35 children, it is utterly unacceptable. And how can those children get the same opportunities as children whose parents are able to afford to buy their education and get them into class sizes where the teacher-pupil ratio is 1 to 16 and the pupil-adult ratio, so support teachers in classrooms, is 1 to 8? There is no comparison. And therefore, if we're going to tackle poverty in the medium term, then we need to give every child, regardless of how rich or not their parents is, the same opportunities to actually get a proper and good education. And likewise, in terms of the skills shortages that we have, the Save the Children say, we believe that it's about scale and pace. We believe the priority for the Scottish Government should be to focus on key drivers of poverty. This includes the jobs market, work opportunities, low-paid roles, even largely held by women, often largely held by women. And that's true, they can't recruit for social care right now. But if you look at the inequalities within social care and the low pay, is it any wonder that they can't recruit? And what about the skills agenda? We look at skills shortages in not just the care sector, in construction. What opportunities are there out there for young people to be able to get into the construction industry? I heard a lorry driver talk the other day about these companies who were quite happy to recruit lorry drivers from abroad on lower pay, but that has actually driven down where the pay should be within that sector. And the specific lorry driver that was being interviewed on the BBC Scotland talked about getting a £20,000 pay rise, and that's where the sector should be. So what opportunities, rather than depending on bringing people to abroad and then paying them low wages, what opportunities are we going to give to give people the education and the skills so that they can get the jobs?
Thank you. I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The reason I became involved in politics was driven by a passion to see Scotland become a fairer and more equal society. I believed then, and I believe even more so now, in that an independent Scotland is the best way to achieve that. I remember growing up in the 1980s, watching the deliberate destruction by a Tory government of Scotland's manufacturing base, of which we're still to recover. At the same time as we watched the acquirement of Trident at the cost today of around £12 billion. Jonathan Haidt, an American author, wrote in his book Righteous Mind, "Everyone cares about fairness, but there are two major kinds. On the left, fairness often implies equality, but on the right, it means proportionality. People should be rewarded in proportion to what they contribute, even if that guarantees unequal outcomes." And how true that is today in Tory Britain. That quote gets straight to the point about what this debate is all about. What kind of country do we want? I want one that places equality, fairness and compassion at its heart. The great Nelson Mandela, in his speech about making poverty history, stated, "Overcoming poverty is not a gesture of charity. It is a protection of a fundamental human right, the right to dignity and a decent life." Right now, the UK government is ready to impose a cut to universal credit. We've heard the Joseph Rowntree Foundation being mentioned a few times, and I'm going to do it again. It estimates that 8,500 families in my constituency and 450,000 in Scotland will lose out, with half of those having children. And indeed, 6 in 10 of all single-parent families in the UK will be impacted. 6 out of 10. Analysis conducted by the Scottish Government in June shows that the plan to cut the £20 per week uplift to universal credit in October could cut social security payments in Scotland alone by over £460 million a year by 2023-24. Withdrawing that payment is expected to push 60,000 people in Scotland into poverty, including 20,000 children. I have 5,000 children in my constituency who are in poverty. So, what is this devolved Scottish Government doing with its limited powers in creating a more equal and fairer Scotland? The announcement of the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, resourced by £500 million over the lifetime of Parliament, is very welcome. It's a step which will help deliver support to families. The Scottish Government is making major progress, taking ambitious steps to tackle child poverty.
promote social justice and create a playing field for young people from low-income backgrounds and their families. That includes investment to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap and support education recovery. In the first 100 days, the Scottish Government paid £100 as part of the £520 support to low-income families, paid the first instalment, £215 million, of the £1 billion Attainment Scotland Fund. And in 2021, the Scottish Government invested around £2.5 billion to support low-income households, including nearly £1 billion to directly supported children. The Scottish Government will roll out the Scottish Child Payment to all under-16s by the end of 2022. Thereafter, the Scottish Government will double the payment to £20 per week as quickly as possible. And I think, as mentioned by my colleague Neil Gray, I look forward to some of these budget discussions coming from the opposition parties about how they're going to pay that. We need the borrowing powers if we're going to meet the demand that's going to come forward. Yeah, of course.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. We heard evidence this morning in the Social Security Committee that a number of the things that we need to do to challenge poverty in the long term, I've got a frog in my throat, sorry, in the longer term, will take much longer than the 2023 targets if we're to meet them. So if you're only going to double, and I hope you double it today, but if you are only going to double the Scottish Child Payment, how do you intend to meet the 2023 target?
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, the member, for the intervention. I think it's a valid point. I think it comes back to the very point that Neil Gray made. Within this Parliament, we don't have the borrowing powers to achieve that. And if we did have that, and it was an independent Scotland, then we'd be able to do that. We have to look at the demand, as Neil said earlier on, and how we have to tackle that. So that gets to the fundamental question that you mentioned. It's the myriad of powers that are here within here in Westminster. We need all the powers here. Yeah, of course.
Michael Marron. Yeah.
Thanks to the member for giving way. What did the member think of the Deputy First Minister's comments on the television this weekend that Scotland would not be able to undertake quantitative easing and therefore would not be able to borrow?
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, again, I think that's something that Scotland still has discussion. I didn't see the interview at all, Mr Mara, so I can't comment on that specific point that was made. But again, it comes back to the borrowing powers that are there. We need to go back to the UK Government and ask for that. So I can't comment that because I didn't see the interview. I want to come back. The Scottish Government has also taken the first step, and this is a real important part that's not been mentioned as well, about establishing a minimum income guarantee, helping ensure everyone in Scotland can live healthy, financially secure and fulfilling lives. I've taken a few and I'm conscious of the time so far. 9 local authorities with Scotland's highest concentrations of deprivation are sharing £43 million of investment. A further £7 million from the schools programme has been shared between 73 additional schools, with the highest concentration of pupils from areas of deprivation. Head teachers are getting an enhanced £147 million of PEF funding to support disadvantaged pupils. And of course, all councils are offering 1140 hours of funded early learning and childcare to eligible children, making high quality early learning and childcare available to families and saving parents of up to £5,000 per year for each eligible child. The recent announcement about the Scottish Government building a system of wraparound school age childcare over the course of the Parliament is much welcome, offering care before and after school and in the holidays, which will be free to families on the lowest income. Presiding Officer, this debate gets to the heart of why we are here, protecting the most vulnerable in our society, providing hope and opportunities. Please support the motion.
Thank you. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be able to take part in this afternoon's debate on supporting a fairer and more equal society. As a Scottish Conservative, I believe in the principles of equality of opportunity. We have a role to play to ensure that what people achieve in life is not determined by where they come from, who their parents are, or where they went to school, but by the drive they have and the determination to succeed. To achieve this, we all need to tackle the root causes of poverty in Scotland. But the SNP record on tackling poverty is quite frankly shocking. Nearly 1 in 5 Scots, or over 1 million people, are living in relative poverty after their housing costs are taken into account. And that statistic rises to 1 in 4 for children across Scotland. These rates have been gradually rising for the last decade. The First Minister claimed in the last Parliament term that education was her number one priority. I want to make some progress. I will take an intervention later. However, she has had to preside over a stubbornly wide attainment gap, which has shown that pupils from more affluent deprived areas are not managing to succeed, and no signs of closing that attainment gap across many different measures. And the usual excuse we hear for this failing is that the nationalist benches tell us they don't have the necessary powers to tackle poverty. But we all know that is simply not the case, Presiding Officer. Despite a range of new welfare powers being devolved in 2016, the SNP have said they'll not be able to fully successfully restore until 2025. 9 years later, Presiding Officer. And remember, this is also the party that said that they could set up an independent Scotland in just 18 months. And in one case, the Social Security Minister simply had to hand back responsibility of benefits to the Department of Work and Pensions because it would avoid unnecessary duplication. Even SNP ministers now seem to see the benefits of having some welfare powers on a UK-wide basis. The proposals put forward by the cobbled-together coalition of the Nationalists and Greens are even worse, being ill thought out and unaffordable. The new coalition has suggested that they will seek to introduce a universal basic income. This scheme is simply gives with one hand and will take with the other. According to the documents released under Freedom of Information by the Scottish Government itself, the scheme could cost the economy £58 billion a year. This policy will put forward, and it only appears to have the appeasement of headline supporters in the coalition of chaos, rather than to target to those people who need the most. And another poor suggestion is the introduction of rent controls. They simply don't work and aren't supported by economists from across the political spectrum. Capping rents will simply make renting out properties a less attractive prospect for landlords who will lead a reduction and they will not be able to supply what is required. And there will be similar proposals. We've heard these similar proposals that took place in Sweden and Stockholm are waiting up to 9 years for a rent-controlled problem resolved. Yet another flashy policy from a party fully looking at not the real problems, but only working towards its goal. And it's been mentioned many times already in this debate that they want full powers for independence. Unlike the Coalition for Chaos, we in the Scottish Conservatives have a real workable solution to tackle the root causes of poverty and will give everyone a chance to succeed. We will deliver the biggest programme of social housing building since the Scottish Parliament reconvened in 1999. We also want to assist in the construction sector, going back to pre-2007 levels. So rather than debating society's proposals like rent controls, we would address the high rents that are increased and ensure that supply and demand to ensure that the supply of houses and the people were able to afford to rent and to buy. We would also provide funds for councils who are delivering many of the frontline services on which the poorest people in our society rely. They have had to deal with squinging cuts over the last few decades from this chamber and from this government. And the Greens and the SNP have put forward budgets over several years that have done that to councils again and again. We would ensure that the increases to the Scottish Government budget were passed directly onto councils to ensure that the funding formula was set in place. This would ensure that councils can continue to deliver vital public services. It's, however, important to point out, Presiding Officer, that there are some areas where we do agree. We were the first party to announce plans to extend free school meals to include all primary school pupils, and I'm pleased to see the Scottish Government has since adopted that policy. We also pledged in our recent election manifesto to double the Scottish child payment. So again, I'm glad to see the Scottish Government is proposing to do the same, but we would like to see it happen much more quickly and within the next financial year. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we in the Scottish Conservatives are committed to tackling the root cause of poverty to ensure equal opportunity for everyone in Scotland. The Nationalist Coalition is so fixed on its holding another referendum on independence to give this important issue the attention it really does deserve. We will continue to hold this government to account for its failings that it has done for years across Scotland, and I support the amendment in the name of Miles Briggs.
Thank you. I call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we all know, the impact of COVID-19 on our society has been huge, and we need bold action to recover. The Cabinet Secretary's motion outlines many of the ambitious plans from the programme for government. We need to rebuild from the pandemic, and we need to grab the opportunity to create a fairer and more equal society. So much of this revolves around education, and as we go forward, it is important to remove barriers and ensure pupils get the most out of their time in education. Since the election, the Scottish Government has already increased school clothing grants and abolished charges for music, art and other practical subjects. The SNP is committed to expanding free school lunches for all primary school pupils and introducing breakfast clubs. These additional measures to tackle the cost of the school day are so important and will ensure more children have the opportunities that they deserve. Early learning and childcare plays a huge role in children's development, and a universal system can do so much to minimise the consequences of poverty on children. Plans to expand early learning and childcare to 1- and 2-year-olds and the introduction of wraparound childcare for school-aged children will benefit children and families immensely. This builds on the achievement of 1140 hours of early learning and childcare funded by the government. I remember as a working parent having to give up my pension contributions so my daughter could go to nursery. There was no way I could afford both, and I am sure this is a problem that many parents and especially mums have faced. For some, the decision could be starker, choosing between work or childcare. It's important that government does as much as possible to support parents in or into the workplace. Many new build nurseries have sprung up across the country. In Easklebride Shopping Centre, we have the new rooftop early learning and childcare centre. The kids there have a huge roof garden where they can play and learn outside safely. Outdoor space is really important, and as part of our efforts to encourage children to get outdoors and help them become more aware and appreciative of our natural environment. No, I'm sorry. I'd like to make progress, thanks. The programme for government gives a welcome commitment. The Scottish Government will continue to promote and support outdoor learning, including Child in Scotland's first outdoor primary learning facilities. I used to work for an outdoor education charity, and we ran a project, Bushcraft Bear, for nursery children from deprived areas. We created our own book starring the bear and the outdoor education instructors. We took children and their favourite soft toy to Shetland Old Country Park with our very own Bushcraft Bear, dressed up as an explorer, and read stories, created a den and foraged for food for the teddies. I saw firsthand the positive outcomes it delivered. For some kids, it was the first time they had experienced being out in the forest. We also gave every child a book voucher and encouraged them to visit the library more often. More importantly, we invited parents and carers to come with us to show that a fun day out doesn't have to be costly. I would like to see schemes like this become more widespread. Delivering outdoor education, reducing the cost of the school day and expanding early years provision will help tackle... No, I'm sorry, I would like to make progress, thanks. And will help tackle some of the problems affecting people who grew up in poverty, including low educational attainment and poorer health outcomes. However, we must eradicate child poverty, and the SNP government will continue to drive forward this national mission. Over 6,000 families in South Lanarkshire have already benefited from the SNP game-changing Scottish Child Payment. We need to tackle the root causes of poverty, and we need to treat people with fairness, dignity and respect. The new Scottish Social Security system does exactly that. And its upcoming introduction of disability benefits will, I am sure, be welcomed by many across the country. Workers deserve fair employment and to earn as a minimum their real living wage. However, we also need to be radical by ensuring all of our fellow citizens have enough money to live on. A minimum income guarantee will give everyone the dignity they deserve. No, I'm sorry, I'd like to make progress, thanks. The foundations for this have been laid and I look forward to hearing the steering group's deliberations on this. However, with most social security powers reserved to the UK government, the Scottish government is acting with one hand tied behind their back. Presiding officer, the Scottish government is working hard using the powers it has to build a fairer country. But the events of the recent weeks show us the limits of what we in this Parliament can do. The Scottish Government will support our young people by removing council tax for under-22s. Meanwhile, at Westminster, Boris Johnson appoints a Deputy Prime Minister who has called for the minimum wage to be scrapped for some people under 21.
If the member could begin to wind up, please.
Okay, thanks. It really is a tale of two governments, as my colleague Neil Gray stated. As we rebuild from the pandemic, we have an opportunity and a duty to make Scotland a more equal and inclusive society. Reality is this. The only way to keep Scotland safe from more Tory cuts and Westminster governments we don't vote for is to become an independent country. So that this Parliament...
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms Stevenson. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The past 18 months have laid bare the brutal inequalities in our society, but they have also revealed our will and our capacity to heal them. More than ever, we recognise how the fundamental pillars of green politics support and strengthen one another, not just environmental sustainability, but social justice, not just non-violence, but genuinely participatory democracy. Our vision and our imperative for action is a Scotland that is fairer, more inclusive, more progressive, and more equal. The history of the last century and the experience of communities across the globe show us the centrality of human rights in achieving that vision. We want to see a Scotland where people understand their rights and those of their neighbours, where they feel valued and included, where they are empowered to claim their own rights and to stand in solidarity, compassion and justice to help others to achieve theirs too. That is why it is so important to embed equality, human rights and inclusion across the entire public sector and especially in government decisions, policies and spending. It is only when those who hold power, us, are reminded day by day of our specific obligations to fairness that we will begin to uproot those structural inequalities that are so deeply rooted and so bitterly toxic. During the coming year, the beginning of consultation on how we embed these principles will be among the most important work that Scottish governments have ever done. In the same way, I warmly welcome the commitment to start consultation on the public sector equality duty in Scotland and the potential regulatory changes that it will require. The new duty on relevant public bodies to develop accessible and inclusive communications and the expansion of existing duties to include reporting on disability and ethnicity pay gaps will be vital tools in creating greater inclusion and fairness. Yes.
Sorry, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Presiding Officer, and thank you for giving way. I look forward to the opportunity to look at those regulations too, and I think they could be transformative. Would you agree with us that we need to make sure that ScotRail, when it's brought into public hands, is also subject to those duties?
Maggie Chapman.
Yes, absolutely. How governments make spending decisions on behalf of people and communities has a huge impact on the direction in which that country moves. So the work of embedding equality and human rights within all stages of the budget process is an essential part of this wider transformation. By taking account of the Equality Budget Advisory Group's recommendations, we can help ensure that spending decisions advance equality and human rights for everyone in Scotland. Yes.
Miles Briggs.
Very much. I thank the member for taking this intervention. Over the last decade, her party has supported the SNP at cutting local government budgets. We've seen a 7% reduction over the last decade. Are we ever going to see that turned round now that she's in government and actually fair funding for local government delivered?
Maggie Chapman.
I would ask the member what his party has managed to achieve through budget negotiations over the last 7 years, and I think that's the answer. As we all know, the moral health of a society can be reliably judged by how it treats its most vulnerable members. I therefore especially welcome the focus on child poverty contained within the new Fairer Scotland Duty guidance. This provides a vital statutory basis for public bodies to consider fundamental issues of socio-economic disadvantage when making their decisions. In the coming year, we will see consultation on a new human rights bill, a key aspect in advancing the 30 recommendations from the National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership. This bill will incorporate, as far as possible within our devolved competence, key human rights treaties. And I'm going to name them all because this will truly be historic, a historic commitment. The International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, and the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. It will also follow international best practice in including a right to a healthy environment and equal access for all, especially both older and LGBTQI plus people, to the rights contained within the bill. And of course, incorporating these treaties into Scots law must be accompanied by decisive, bold action. The right to adequate housing is one of the ICESCR's central provisions, and we in the Greens have been especially determined to realise that right for private sector tenants. We welcome the start that has already been made in working towards ensuring that everyone has a safe, warm place to call home, with rights and security regardless of tenure. We will work actively in bringing about the New Deal for tenants, ensuring quality of outcomes and protection. We look forward to enhanced tenants' rights, including greater flexibility to make their homes their own, keep beloved companion animals, and greater protection from winter evictions, more stringent penalties for unscrupulous landlords, an effective national system of rent controls, and a rent guarantor for estranged young people. Taken together, this represents the biggest transformation for tenants in decades, and I'm pleased that the Greens secured this as part of the cooperation agreement. Presiding Officer, a few months ago, I said in this chamber that at the heart of our collective well-being must be social security, not a system or an idea, but a fundamental right. We know that the societies that guarantee their citizens social security are the societies that perform best. They have the longest life expectancy, the lowest levels of crime, the highest levels of innovation and economic performance.
Ms. Chapman, could you bring your remarks to close, please?
I'm about to close. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Well, you go over your time, so please do so now. Thanks.
There is so much more I'd like to say on carer disability benefits, on child poverty and more. But I will close by
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I had asked you to close. Thank you. Our next speaker will be Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm delighted to be able to speak to the motion today. Presiding Officer, I am a firm believer that we should always strive to do the best for our communities. And I also sincerely believe that is what our Scottish Government are doing with the Programme for Government and the specific interventions outlined within today's motion. These interventions will be simply game-changing for the individuals, the families and the children who are in need of our help. However, whilst these interventions are very welcome, we must also admit that they can only go so far. Our Scottish Government can only do so much while continually fighting against the tide of, quite frankly, downright disgraceful decisions made by the Tories at Westminster. The Westminster Tories are removing the £20 uplift to universal credit, plunging over 8,000 people in Aberdeen alone into poverty. Nationally, this figure exceeds 241,000 people, and by removing this £20 uplift, it reduces their household incomes by £1,040 a year. Let me say that again, £1,040 per year stripped from those in most need within our society, forcing some families and individuals to make horrendous decisions to either feed their children or to heat their home, to make the horrendous decision as to who gets to eat that day, themselves or their children. That is the reality many will face once the universal credit uplift is ripped from the pockets of those most in need. In recent weeks, we have heard of yet another hammer blow by Westminster, again hitting the poorest in our society through the raising of national insurance to pay for social care in England and Wales, a provision in Scotland that is already funded by the Scottish Government. Whilst we do not know the full extent of the damage this will do, members should be under no illusion that these decisions will be less money in the pockets of the lowest paid workers within our constituencies. That's less money to buy food, less money to pay bills, and less money to meet the expenses of daily life. Presiding officer, I firmly believe that the Tories at Westminster have absolutely no interest in creating a more equal society. All I can see coming from Westminster is the broadening of the gap between the richest and the poorest of our society and forcing more working families onto the breadline. In stark contrast to this, the Scottish Government has committed to an ambitious programme for government. A programme which I think my friend Neil Gray said earlier will invest around £2.5 billion to support low-income households. A programme which commits nearly £1 billion to directly support our children and pupils who live in Scotland's most deprived communities will be amongst those set to benefit from a record investment of over £215 million of targeted funded in this financial year to help close the poverty-related attainment gap. The Scottish Government is also committed to delivering a doubling of the carers' allowance supplement. This will be a very welcome boost to the inadequate payments again made by the UK Government. The SNP has also committed to doubling the Scottish child payment and extending the payment to all eligible under 16s by the end of 2022.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you to the member for giving way. On the carers' benefit point, we too support the doubling of the carers' benefit, of course, because it will put more money in carers' pockets. But what do you and your government intend to do for the 39,000 people who have an underlying entitlement to carers' benefit but will not receive the supplement?
Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to think that the Scottish Government have got that within their sights and will hopefully be able to deliver. I don't have the answer to you, I'm sorry, but I'm sure the Scottish Government are very much aware of that. We have committed to expanding free school meals provision, extended childcare provision to 1,140 hours, and are committed to support working families with the provision of wraparound care and the provision of care for 1- and 2-year-olds. The Scottish Government is also investing over £12 million to provide access to free welfare and money advice services, ensuring that those constituents who are struggling the most have access to good quality advice and support to allow them to maximise their incomes. And this will be greatly received, I know, from a lot of my constituents in Aberdeen Donside. Presiding Officer, as we rebuild from the pandemic, we have an opportunity to make Scotland a more equal and inclusive society. However, Scotland does not hold all the powers it requires to achieve this. The UK Government has shown time and time again that they do not hold the same progressive values with regards to equality and fairness as Scotland, and this only reaffirms the need for Scotland's future to be in Scotland's hands. Presiding Officer, I believe the Scottish Government will do all that's within its power and will continue to fight tooth and nail for equality in Scotland. And I also truly believe only once all decisions are made here will we be able to achieve our goal of truly becoming a fair, equal and prosperous country. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mbar. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Bob Doris. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the first steps towards building a fairer and more equal society is to ensure all children get a fair start in life, no matter where they are born. All too often, the issues of rural poverty are swept beneath the carpet, out of sight and out of mind. As our world becomes even more connected, the communities on our periphery are being left behind. Ensuring rural communities are connected with young people afforded the same opportunities as their urban counterparts is a key part of this challenge, and nowhere in Scotland is this more evident than Ayrshire. Looking at the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, sadly, several communities in Ayrshire appear in the top 10% of Scotland's most deprived areas. However, the majority of these areas lie outside of Ayr in the countryside, which, despite being a few miles from the promenades of Troon and Prestwick, feel a million miles away. For example, I recently visited towns in rural East Ayrshire during my street surgery tour, an area that is some of the highest levels of deprivation in the country. While there, residents pointed out the number of derelict buildings in one of the towns, with 12 in one street alone. The effects of housing poverty can be felt clearly in rural communities, and derelict buildings are the final results. Without adequate funds to keep houses in good condition, living standards deteriorate, causing further hardship and stigma, with a knock-on effect on young people's development. In East Ayrshire, 37% of buildings failed the Scottish housing quality standard, with that figure rising to 46% for South Ayrshire, nearly half the local authority's dwellings. 41% were judged to have critical elements of disrepair. In other words, they are flawed in terms of weather tightness and structural stability. While 25% of South Ayrshire dwellings were in need of immediate repair, affecting a horrifying 34% of families. Fuel poverty is another issue that holds back people in rural areas. In East Ayrshire, fuel poverty affects 15,000 households, including 2,000 families. Meanwhile, in South Ayrshire, a wealthier local authority, a staggering 12,000 households are affected, nearly a quarter of all households. In South Ayrshire, the fuel poverty gap, in other words, the amount of money it would take to pull households out of fuel poverty, has reached £850, truly highlighting the disadvantage at which many in rural communities find themselves.
Cabinet Secretary.
Does she think that the cut to universal credit will help those people that she's just been talking about who are in fuel poverty in those communities? Will it help or hinder them to have £20 a week taken off them?
Sharon Dowie.
We fully supported the temporary uplift in the universal credit during the height of the pandemic. But now that we're coming through, we need to try and get people back into work. And people in my area don't want to live in benefits. They want investment from this government to go into that area.
Cabinet Secretary.
Recognise that many of those people on universal credit are already working, but they don't earn enough in order to have the type of living standards that she's talking about. Removing the £20 will just make that situation worse. Surely she can see that.
Sharon Dowie.
I've been to the DWP and I've spoken to people that work there, and they think this is the best system to try and encourage people to get into work. So we need to invest. We need to invest in rural communities, and we need to give people the opportunity to get into work. And we'll continue.
Could we have fewer comments from the sedentary position, please? Ms Dowie, please continue.
I'm going to make some progress, thank you. A doubling of the Scottish child payment would go some way towards resolving these issues, but it is not enough on its own, and it takes no account of rural and urban disparities.
Could we all stop? Sorry, Ms Dowie, please resume your seat for a second. Could we all stop having sedentary conversations and chattering? We'd like to hear Ms Dowie. Ms Dowie, please resume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has many worthy aims when it comes to resolving poverty, but often there is too much talk followed by too little change. Education followed by consistent employment is, and always will be, the best way to deliver real economic change in a community. Making sure we have the appropriate tools in place is an essential step on the road to reducing rural poverty. Inward investment is one mechanism, as is education, but employability programmes also have a role to play. With that in mind, I decided to look at how the Scottish Government's employability programmes had progressed. However, Presiding Officer, I was surprised at the results, and not in a good way. Fair Start Scotland has been operational since 2018, but its performance has been disappointing. In the first quarter of April 2018, only 14% of starts sustained 1 year of employment. Those figures have not improved, and the pandemic is no excuse. In the final quarter of 2019, only 9% of starts stayed in a job for a year. While the pandemic has undoubtedly had an impact, during the height of COVID, in October to December 2020, 38% of starts began a job. That figure has plummeted to 9% in the second quarter of this year. In June 2021, only 76 participants had achieved 12 months' work out of 878 starts the previous year. If we're serious about curbing rural unemployment, then the Cabinet Secretary needs to get a grip on Scotland's employability programme. The number of Scots using devolved social security programmes is set to rise exponentially in the effects of the pandemic are felt and further benefits are devolved. We need robust measures in place to boost rural employment, cut rural poverty and end rural barriers to employment. With that in mind,
I hope to see
the Scottish Government taking more positive action to bring genuine change to these forgotten communities.
Thank you. Could I next call Bob Doris to be followed by Martin Whitfield? Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think this Parliament does a really good job at hiding where there can be consensus and agreement from time to time. Perhaps I should leave the Conservatives to one side when I talk about that consensus and agreement in the most. But I do recall attending events in our Parliament in the last session to hear the case for £5 per week per child as an anti-poverty supplement. And as a backbencher of government, I took those calls seriously, as did the SNP government and members across this chamber. And the Scottish Government announced in 2019 that rather than a £5 per week child supplement, this would now be a Scottish child payment. They've introduced to families and qualifying benefits as a £10 per week per child payment. No rape clause, no two child cap, a straightforward, forthright, direct payment to those most in need and in poverty. And we've got agreement across this chamber. We got consensus. This was to be extended to all under-16s, first starting with under-6s. The announcement was a victory and a vindication for campaigners. They had showed movement as well. They wanted a universal £5 payment at the outset, and we've now moved to a £10 targeted payment. And of course, since then, the SNP has fast-tracked both the delivery and rollout to under-16s for the Scottish Child Payment and brought in bridging payments, as we've heard. And most recently, SNP MSPs were elected on the commitment to raise the Scottish Child Payment to £20 per child per week. Commitments made across this chamber, indeed, and our Scottish Government will do so. And I absolutely accept that campaigners wish to see this happen as soon as possible. And there's always demands on government money. When we're bringing in the Scottish Child Payment, rather than increase it further, one of those suggestions made by anti-poverty groups was, if you have additional money, perhaps give it to teenage children's families during the summer, another pinch point when families were in poverty. There's always many ways to spend money in this chamber to tackle those, to help those living in poverty. We should bear that in mind. Together with various others, direct policy initiatives from this government to tackle child poverty, such as Best Start grants, Best Start foods, increasing the Scottish School Clothing Grant and rolling out further free school meals, the Scottish Government clearly have a policy programme which is taking seriously action to tackle child poverty, and with it bringing a fairer and more equal society that this debate is focused on. No complacency there, Presiding Officer, and of course we must strive to do more. Entitlements and support must not only exist, their uptake must be maximised. I welcome the Scottish Government embraces its statutory duty to promote benefit uptake. A similar statutory duty does not exist at Westminster. With regards to the Scottish Child Payment, once rolled out, the Scottish Government anticipated an 83% uptake. Of course, it wanted 100%, but it estimated 83%. And I absolutely welcome that 108,000 children have benefited to the tune of £176 million from February, when it was introduced, to the 30th of June this year. With around 133,000 forecast to be eligible, that would suggest an uptake of around perhaps 80% or so. I'm not sure about that figure. I would also note Spice suggests initially the uptake was around 60%. So it's really quite important to work out what that uptake is currently and what we're doing to address any uptake gap. Those missing out may indeed be the most vulnerable. I know that the Scottish Government is distributing £12 million this year to support the provision of free welfare and debt advice. And I commend the work of various groups and organisations, be they citizens' advice bureaus, local authority welfare workers, or various other groups working in debt support advice and income maximisation. However, it's often the most vulnerable families who don't go to these bodies. And in my constituency in Maryhill and Springburn, I'm lucky to have on the ground trusted organisations who don't just offer practical support for those most vulnerable, they also seek to ensure individuals and families are plugged into the wider benefits system. I would note two of those, there are many, but I would note the Glasgow North Baby Food Bank and Spirit of Springburn. Glasgow North Baby Food Bank don't just give out baby formula, nappies, clothes, moral support, peer support. They also signpost those individuals and families to Scottish Social Security benefits to make sure they get what they're entitled to. And Spirit of Springburn has a hub in the heart of the Springburn community, bringing services to the people that most need them. They don't get direct funding from government. Perhaps we have to do more to build community resilience, such as offered by Glasgow North Baby Food Bank and Spirit of Springburn. In the time I have left, I want to talk about the £20 cut in universal credit. Presiding officer, you weren't in the chamber at the time, but I used that expression, you, in an intervention to Miles Briggs time and again, and I apologise for that. It's not parliamentary etiquette. But I was so impacted by the looming cut, the catastrophe that the £20 cut in universal credit will bring to my constituents, I lost that parliamentary etiquette. There's a bit of a false debate in relation to this cut. Universal credit was not sufficient before the £20 uplift was brought in. It was never enough to live on. I had constituents already going to food banks, already in poverty, already not heating their homes because benefits were too low. And £20 a week just about got them to hang in there. Just about got them to hang in there. And now it's been stripped away again. It's disgraceful. It's appalling. It's shameful. It's not dignified. It's quite simply wrong, and the Conservatives in Scotland should get a backbone and stand up to their UK masters and stand up for the poorest in Scotland and across the UK. Presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr Dorris. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a great pleasure to follow Bob Dorris and his thoughtful contribution, particularly with regard to universal credit, and particularly I echo his comments that even before the £20 uplift, the pressure on families, families with children, families who were in work, was quite simply unacceptable. And I do welcome the thought behind today's motion about an ambitious programme for government to create a fairer society. But I would like to take a moment to consider what we mean by fairer society. A number of speakers this afternoon have spoken about an equitable society. A number of speakers have spoken about a fair society. And I want to just look at what that means, because we have people living in our society, in our communities now. And I have to confess, as a primary school teacher, I have sat through, and I say this very carefully, perhaps some very convoluted assemblies where I have heard adults try to explain to children what fairer and what equity and what equitable means. And as I say that with my fingers crossed to the head teachers who I know are probably immediately emailing me. Because to explain what a fairer society is needs to get down to a simple principle. If you say to a child, is it fair? If they've not benefited, they'll say no. So is a fairer society about everyone being equal? I deeply hope, that we all in this chamber can agree it is not about everyone being the same. Indeed, I'm minded of Clarence Drummond, one of the first human rights lawyer in the US, who took part in the monkey trial, when they were trying to stack the jury, he said, conform, conform, what do you want? Do you want to run them through a meat grinder so they all come out the same? I hope everyone in this chamber, indeed I hope everyone across Scotland, do not want a society where everything is the same. Richard Lavoy, the educationalist, has said, the definition of fairness, well, it means everyone gets what he or she needs. And I think that flexibility is very important going forward. And I welcome the fact that so much of today's motion concentrates on our young people, because that is important, and it's crucial that the society we bequeath them is one that is fairer, is one that they feel attached to, is one that they feel that they have contributed to. But it's not enough to have slogans, it's not enough to have promises, it's not even enough to rebrand previous offers. 19% of Scotland's population, 1.03 million people each year, are living in relative poverty. Take away housing costs, that's 17%. And child poverty levels in this country are an absolute disgrace. We have young families and we have young people and their families in this society who are supported by food banks, who are supported by the third sector groups, who are supported by charities, churches, who are supported by their friends and neighbours. They're supported by local authorities, and I welcome work that's being done there. Indeed, East Lothian Council's poverty plan has been well received, but 25% of children in East Lothian are living in poverty, as expressed by their constituency MSP Paul so eloquently. 26% of the children who live in the Borders, 24% who live in Dumfries and Galloway. We can't live in a society where one child is hungry. And that's what we should aim to. On current figures, without an alteration to the Scottish Child Payment, we will miss the target. We, this chamber, this government, we who have been elected to look after and support people, will miss the target that's been set. That's unacceptable. Scottish Labour have made the choice, and I know Neil is Grace not in his seat, but I'm sure would leap up and intervene and say, where is the money coming from? But Scottish Labour have made the choice that that should be doubled and doubled again next year. Why? So that 80,000 pupils, children and young people can be lifted out of poverty. And it is a question of choices. It's a question of what is important, what lies at the heart. We heard this earlier on that Pandan Glancy mentioned that Social Security has to do the heavy lifting in the short term. Please.
Cabinet Secretary.
On that point, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation was very clear that it is not sustainable to expect Social Security to solve poverty or child poverty. It has to include employability and reducing costs. Do you agree with their position?
Absolutely.
Martin Whitfield.
My apologies, Deputy Presiding. Absolutely. It is not for Social Security to pay for everybody forever, because that reduces the dignity that people find as individuals. But it is right in the short term that we use Social Security to do the heavy lifting and get these children, get these children's families out of poverty, so that as we look to their education, they feel more able to contribute and learn. As they go on to find jobs, they can hang on for a job that they feel more fitted to rather than the first thing that comes along, often pressed on them by those who administer the Social Security. So I agree it is not the single answer, but I suggest it is the answer going forward. So with the bridging payments, we have children who can receive that without the need to be on free school meals. So after the abhorrent £20 cut, children in Scotland whose families will lose universal credit can continue to receive the Scottish Child Benefit. I know time is very short and I want to make one mention which I would ask for
a response. Yes, if you could do it very quickly, please, because time is very, very short.
I agree, it's very quick. The UNHCR case at the Supreme Court is about to be handed down. Will the government confirm that it will provide primary legislation time should that be needed to bring it into force? I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. And I now call Joel Fitzpatrick up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, from my constituency office, I can see the Social Security Scotland headquarters building at Dundee Waterfront. By autumn next year, 3,500 people will be employed by the agency across Scotland, including up to 900 in my constituency. And we heard this week that a further 300 jobs are set to be created nearby at the new NHS 24 regional hub in the city. Presiding Officer, the SNP are delivering for Dundee. As we've heard, Social Security Scotland are delivering the game-changing Scottish child payment to low-income families, which will be doubled to £20 per week per child as quickly as possible. Social Security Scotland are also delivering the new child disability payment in three pilot areas, including in my constituency in Dundee. Presiding officer, where the actions of the Scottish Government are compared with the actions of the UK Government, it is clear who is serious about tackling poverty in Scotland. The Tories have imposed the bedroom tax, the benefits cap, the five-week wait for the failing universal credit, benefit sanctions, the two-child cap and the abhorrent rape clause. And last night, Scottish Tory MPs at Westminster sat on their hands as Boris Johnson bulldozed through his £20 a week cut to universal credit, which, as many others have said, will push thousands of children in Scotland into poverty. As the Cabinet Secretary put it last week, it is a total disgrace that Tory MPs who come into this Parliament demanding that the Scottish Government plug the holes that their own government is creating at Westminster and have the brass neck to do so. The Tories really need to get their own house in order. Presiding officer, I am proud of the steps being taken by the Scottish Government to eradicate poverty. The Scottish Government is delivering for Dundee, including over £4.2 million to 3,700 Dundee carers through our Carers Action Supplement. Mr. Mara.
Michael Mara.
I thank the member for giving way. I mean, I think there's a slight dissonance between the rhetoric and the reality. He must know that poverty in Dundee has continued to increase dramatically. Child poverty is increasing dramatically under this government. Drug deaths are increasing dramatically. The outcomes for the people of our city...
Mr. Mara, an intervention, not a speech, please. Mr. Fitzpatrick.
I thank the member for his intervention. Clearly, no one is suggesting that poverty does not exist in Scotland, which is why the Scottish Government takes this so seriously, which is why the Scottish Government is investing so hard in this area. But it is so difficult when every time we take an action, those actions are reversed and gone against by actions of the Westminster Government, which we then have to mitigate against. So for Dundee, over £4.2 million to Dundee's 3,700 carers with a carers allowance supplement, over £1 million via the Two Families Pandemic Supplement, supporting 5,422 children and young people in our city, over £1.7 million via the Best Start Grant and Best Start Foods, over £500,000 in funeral support payments, supporting people at that most difficult time in their lives. Of course.
Miles Briggs.
What impact does the Minister think cutting £20 million from drug and alcohol partnerships had in the City of Dundee?
Joe Fitzpatrick.
So, obviously, I'm not a minister. I think if we look at the budgets over the last number of years, certainly for the last 3 years, the budgets for alcohol and drug partnerships in Scotland have risen year on year. And I think you'll see that in this year's budget, there's been a significant investment of new cash, which I welcome. Clearly, we have more to do, and I hope it's one of the things that we can actually work together on. But there's other things that the Scottish Government have done for Dundee. So the free school breakfasts and lunches, which being expanded to all primary school pupils, benefiting over 10,000 children in Dundee alone, and over 6,000 children and young people in our city receiving the school clothing grant. Sadly, the progressive and ambitious... I'll need to make some progress, sorry. I'll bring you in later if I can. Sadly, the progressive and ambitious work of the Scottish Government is constantly being undermined by the callous approach of the Tories at Westminster, slavishly backed by their Tory colleagues here in this chamber, who will defend the indefensible to preserve their precious union. Presiding officer, Scotland cannot afford to remain part of this sinking ship that is the United Kingdom. Imagine what we could achieve in this Parliament if we had the full control of the Scottish welfare system, like any other normal country in the world. I look forward to supporting the forthcoming independence referendum bill once the COVID crisis is over, so that the people of Scotland can choose whether to remain shackled to Boris Johnson's Brexit Britain or choose independence, which will deliver the full range of powers to enable this Parliament to put in place the transformational recovery, one which will lead to a fairer, more sustainable and prosperous nation. and a Scotland which would be able to work in partnership with our friends in the rest of the UK and Europe in genuine partnership of equals. Often when we talk about independence in this chamber, there is complaints from Tories that we need to focus on the day job. But we've had an election, and the result of the election was clear and decisive. The people of Scotland delivered their verdict on the Tories' fundamentally undemocratic position that says that Scotland should never, the people of Scotland should never have the chance to choose again. There was a clear majority in this Parliament in favour of an independence referendum. Presiding officer, that is what this Parliament is duty-bound to deliver on behalf of the people of Scotland who we serve, and that is what I will be proud to support when the time comes. Presiding officer, to conclude, I support the motion and particularly welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to put human rights at the centre of our COVID recovery, and which will see a new human rights bill introduced by the Scottish Government incorporating all the conventions
laid out
by Maggie Chapman earlier. I hope that this is one of the areas where, while we differ on other areas, I hope this is one of the areas that the Parliament can work together to do what's best for Scotland.
Thank you, Ms.
Fitzpatrick.
Point of order, Mr. Dorris.
Presiding officer, earlier in my speech, I mentioned a Springburn organisation called Spirit of Springburn and the wonderful job that they do. But what I didn't do is declare that I am a director of Spirit of Springburn, as I should have done. So I now place that on the record, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Dorris, and that indeed is now on the record. I now move to winding up speeches, and I call on Michael Mara to wind up for Labour. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and for giving me the opportunity to follow on from my Dundee colleague Joe Fitzpatrick, more of which later. This weekend, during the online SNP conference, the First Minister took a short break from setting out conspiracy theories to tell us that Scotland can be Denmark, can be Ireland, can be Austria, Norway, Finland. I mean, personally, I quite like being Scottish, but given all this, perhaps there should be no surprise to see the government taking on the language of America and the United States and the land of opportunity that we've heard not very much about today. For while on these benches we of course strongly believe in opportunity, it isn't really what the focus of this motion or this debate has been about. For the grasping of opportunities can only become a reality when there is a universal realisation of rights. The right not to be hungry, the right to a decent education, the right to live free of the indignity of poverty. And I think my colleague Martin Whitfield was incredibly eloquent in painting that picture and the need for the realisation of those rights. And I hope that the Minister picks up on his point regarding the implementation of government legislation for the realisation of rights legislation. But these are fundamental principles that should exist within our social contract. But that is not really what this debate was about this afternoon. Because the language of opportunity, perhaps surrounding these core issues, I think, shifts significantly that issue of social contract. It speaks not really about equality, but to a wider sense of individualism. And perhaps we hear a little bit of what Susan Aitken's analysis, that we should have the opportunity to empty our own bins, the opportunity to sweep our own streets, and the opportunity to run our own libraries. So, Presiding Officer, maybe to end this analogy, borrowing this language from Mitt Romney and Marco Rubio signals a new, more honest direction from the government on how the society should look. Or perhaps it's just a little bit odd, and it's a tired attempt from a press officer or a civil servant to rebadge what has been a dull and timid programme for government. The Minister started the debate by saying that the government were well aware of the challenge ahead. I have to say, across a wide range of portfolios, it doesn't really seem like it. There is a real lack of ambition in terms of around our education remobilisation, the remobilisation of our NHS, which we've heard so much about today, and the crisis that we see in our social services. But the Minister talked about rights. She did talk about a list of bills, rights consultations, rights discussion groups. And this rights framework, frankly, has very little to say about the reality of the city in which we both live, in Dundee. I think the Minister mentioned Housing First. What she didn't mention was that the 12 staff in the Housing First programme have been made redundant, and 4 staff have had the full responsibilities of that programme taken on top of their own jobs as a result of the funding ending and not being replaced by this government. She talked about protection of women and girls, but we didn't mention that the fact that refuges in the city of Dundee are often full with no access available when a woman seeks refuge for her and her family. Please, do.
Cabinet Secretary.
So would the member recognise that in recognition of the services provided by Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland, we provided £5 million of additional money in order to help them meet the increased demand due to COVID? Would he not recognise that and welcome that?
Michael Mara.
Thank you. Thanks for the intervention. I recognise certainly that there was money gone in recently, but I can tell you in recent weeks there are still incredibly long waiting lists for one-to-one work between women and Women's Aid in Dundee, and that resource is not changing that situation. The refuges have been full in recent years and continue to be in a state of extreme pressure. So we have to think about the reality involved in this government policy. I think Pam Duncan-Glancy talked to that very clearly when she frankly skewered the minister on the issue of the 125,000 young people missing out on bridging payments due to the approach taken by this government in a speech that was frankly our customary tour de force across these issues. Praise that Willie Rennie gave as well and went on to highlight the key statistic that I think we're all taking note of in this debate today. About 25% of children living in poverty in Scotland, rising to 38% in 10 years' time. And Alec Rowley talked about that statistic and rightly told us that governments can and should do more, as Gordon Brown and Labour did. Simply put, warm words don't put food on the table. We need pounds in the pocket to actually make a difference. And I think Mr Rowley made that point very strongly indeed, that Labour took 1 million children out of poverty, and that child poverty now continues to rise year on year under this, both of these governments. So the immediate moral imperative for this government is to live up to its end of the social contract. It should be to eradicate the scourge of child poverty in Scotland. In my home city of Dundee, over 25% of children are living in poverty. 7,046 children and families who need our support now. And I'm afraid the picture that Mr Fitzpatrick portrayed of that city and the challenges that, that we face didn't actually meet the mark. I would say he asked us to imagine what could be achieved. I would ask him to imagine what could be achieved if 1 in 8 teachers hadn't been taken out of the schools in Dundee by the SNP Council, whose budget has been cut by the SNP government. So the analysis shows that £40 per week Scottish child payment would lead to child poverty reduction of up to 80,000 children in Scotland. And Neil Gray said we were asking for very little. That is not very little. That is a significant move. Yes.
Neil Gray.
Thank Michael Mara for giving way, and I don't doubt the sincerity by which he makes his case, nor Pam Duncan-Glancy or any of his colleagues, because I share that sincerity, that the drive to drive down poverty. But why wasn't that commitment to £40 in the manifesto that is just 4 months old that the Labour Party stood on 4 months ago?
Michael Mara.
What we have done is we have seen that the writing under this government is on the wall. Frankly, that child poverty targets are going to be missed. And also what we have done as a party is we have listened. We've listened to the faith leaders across Scotland, listened to the hundreds of third sector organisations that are telling us to take this action. And I would say to Mr Gray that the public accounts show us that the government has more money this year than it has in previous years and is likely, frankly, under this Tory administration to have for years to come. I would ask the question, if not now, then when? If not now, then when will you have the resource to do it? And Mr Gray seemed to indicate in his retreat to this issue of powers that actually that we needed borrowing, more borrowing to do this. And Mr McLennan couldn't answer my point. I understand he missed the piece on the telly where the Deputy First Minister said an independent Scotland would not have quantitative easing and could not borrow. So frankly, when Mr Gray accuses us of being slightly confused, I think he would take
Mr.
that
Mark,
point.
Could you please conclude?
To conclude, I think the broad consensus across the chamber is a clear issue that the Tories and that Miles Briggs's point on this, that we have to make sure that their position on the £20 uplift is frankly indefensible. But there's a moral imperative that this Scottish Government acts.
Thank you, Mr Mara. I now call on Jeremy Balfour to wind up for the Conservatives. Up to 8 minutes, please, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The pursuit of a fair and equal society is an endeavour that we all have a part to play in. With so many different areas that must be addressed, it will take all of us to strive for our goal. We must be ambitious in our plans to tackle issues of inequality, but more importantly, we must deliver on that ambition. Unfortunately, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Government is very good at ambition, but woefully inadequate at the delivery. We have heard across the Chamber of all the times that the SNP have failed to deliver a fair and equal chance for the people of Scotland. My colleague Miles Briggs highlighted the role of unpaid carers and young carers, and yet no one has addressed the points that he has raised, and I hope the Government will in their conclusion. My colleague Pam Gozo laid out the dreadful and truly heartbreaking disparity in her area, whether it be in school performance, homelessness or life expectancy. The postcode lottery should not determine your school results, whether or not you have a home, and certainly not how long you live. Alexander Stewart referred to the fact that the Government has handed powers out over devolved benefits in 2016 and still haven't finished taking full control over them until at least 2025. It will take almost a decade before they get their affairs in order, and yet they keep saying they want more powers. Sorry.
Neil Gray.
I merely point out to Jeremy Balfour that we have one government that's investing in social security and a government that he supports that is cutting social security. Did he hear Stephen Crabb, the former DWP Secretary of State, yesterday, when he said that it was a mistake for him to assume that cutting social security would get people into work? That was a mistake, and he backed the policy that is supported by this government, which is to see the universal credit uplift retained.
Mr Balfour.
I think my colleague, Mr Briggs, made clear that we would have preferred an extension, if possible. But we also recognise, as you've recognised, that there are financial choices that have to be made. All we have heard from the SNP benches this afternoon is, let's have more power, but we've heard over and over again that we haven't even been delivered on the powers that we have already. They slag off DWP, but without DWP, poor people would be even poorer and people wouldn't be getting benefits. We've heard from my colleague, Sharon Dowie, of a terrible lack of opportunities affordable to our rural communities. Again, be it education, employment. Presiding Officer, at this point, I want to go back and echo my colleague, Alexander Stewart, ensure that we as a Conservatives believe in equality of opportunity. The hallmark of a fair society is that one allows individuals to thrive regardless of their situation, where they're born into, what type of family they live in. Child poverty is a massive problem here in Scotland. I would love the Minister to tell me we have the same powers north and south of the border. Why are more disabled people in employment in England compared to Scotland? Because this government, I think, needs to answer these questions rather than slagging off other governments. As I've been mentioned earlier, it is estimated that almost a quarter of children in Scotland are living in relative poverty after housing costs. That statistic doesn't hit you like a punch in the gut. You surely aren't grasping the magnitude of it. Are you going to tell me about disability?
Cabinet Secretary.
So you're talking about child poverty, and you've said that your government needs to make difficult financial choices while demanding that this government double Scottish child payment immediately. Don't you see the irony in that? Surely these are people who are receiving money, Scottish families. How can you justify £20 coming out of those families' hands?
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary. Before Mr Balfour resumes, can we just remind members that they speak through the chair and therefore they should not refer to other members as you. Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy President. The answer is that all five parties had that in our manifestos. We want to deliver on our manifestos because we have listened to the faith groups, we've listened to the third sector. We say this needs to be done. You have simply got
Cabinet Secretary.
So you're talking about organisations that have quite rightly lobbied. So the member... The member has talked about organisations that are quite rightly calling for the doubling of child payment. Those same organisations are telling members on that side of the chamber that it is the wrong thing to do to cut universal credit by £20. Why are you only listening to them on one issue and not the other?
Mr Balfour?
Deputy President, I may be wrong on this, but I understand this is the Scottish Parliament and we have responsibility for Scottish decisions. Now, I know if you want to go and discuss universal credit, stand down and get yourself elected to Westminster. But please, let's focus in. No more time. Let's focus in on what we can do in this Parliament with the powers that we have, rather than keep focusing on other governments. It is of utmost importance that we as a Parliament seek... No, I have no more time, sorry. As I've said, many charities have stated that it would make a massive difference. Doubling the Scottish Child Payment to £20 will have an immediate impact on the number of children in poverty, lifting tens of thousands of children from most tragic circumstances. Of course, it's no way a silver bullet, but it would make a difference, a real difference, and it's something that I can do and all 128 other members can do when we vote on a budget in a few months' time. Deputy Presiding Officer, if this government wants to take seriously these issues, it must stop all the talk, roll up its sleeves and deliver effective policies that will actually promote a fairer and more equal society. And what would be a better way to start? By ceasing to kick women down the road and double the Scottish Child Payment now, commit to it to now, vote for Miles Briggs' amendment and let's give a clear message that we understand what the Scottish people want us to do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. And I now call on Shirley-Ann Somerville to wind up the debate for the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank all members for their contributions today? We have, I think, quite understandably heard a lot about the anti-poverty measures that are being taken by the Scottish Government, and particularly around the Scottish Child Payment. And we, of course, heard that directly right at the start from Miles Briggs, and we have heard it from many others. It is, of course, this Government's intention to double the Scottish Child Payment to £20 as early as possible in this parliamentary session. This is, after all, a benefit that went from announcement to delivery in 18 months, which is a record delivery for our new social security system. Yes.
Pam Duncan-Clancy.
Thank you, and you're quite right, it is record delivery. Can we replicate that with some of the other benefits then, so that people don't have to wait to the likes of 2025 in order to get more eligibility or adequacy of payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll come on to some of this if I have time, Presiding Officer, in more detail. But what I would absolutely point the member to is that we are already delivering 11 benefits through Social Security Scotland, 11, seven of which are brand new and unique. And some of the reasons why we are taking some time to develop the policy with those with lived experiences to get this right, but also to ensure that we have a stable system that will allow us then to make the change. And that's something that I, when I was Social Security Secretary, did work very carefully with stakeholders on the reasons for that. But can I get back to this issue on the Scottish Child Payment? Because I think it was very telling as we went on. We heard about the Scottish Child Payment and we heard about universal credit, although apparently, according to General Jeremy Balfour, we shouldn't debate universal credit and we should just leave it to Westminster. He'll forgive me if I don't take that offer up. It is a choice. We all have choices, so I would happily give way to any of the Scottish Conservatives here who would like to intervene today, and anyone who would want to condemn the UK Government, and if not go as far as that, to at least cajole the UK Government into dropping their threat for the UK Government to take that £20 cut to universal credit. Anyone?
Miles Briggs.
I'll say the exact point I said to one of our backbenchers is my motion today looks towards making sure we double the child payment in this financial year. Now, will members support that, or are you about to vote against it in this Parliament?
Shirley-Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there we go, Presiding Officer. At least Miles Briggs had the decency to stand up and attempt to defend the UK Government while the rest of his backbenchers and frontbenchers sat and looked at the floor, because no one will actually do that in the Scottish Tories, and I think that is a testimony to where their priorities lie, and as Jeremy Balfour said, the choices that they have made on this. We've set out very clearly what we'll do in the Scottish Child Payment, and I look forward to when it comes to the budget debates about what will happen in this debate from every single party as we move forward with costed budgets on this. Pam Duncan-Glancy, as always in her contributions within the Scottish Parliament, gave a very thoughtful, considered approach to her contribution. But I would urge her to caution on some issues. We would all love to get on with it when it comes to aspects, but on specifically on the Scottish Child Payment, as Shona Robinson pointed out when she was making an intervention, we are providing bridging payments to make sure we're getting on with this. Now, Pam Duncan-Glancy did mention that this doesn't match to everyone who would be getting the Scottish Child Payment. This is simply because we do not have the data to be able to allow us to deliver on that. So while, yes, it is a commendable desire for us to be able to do that, we can only work with what we have. We can only work with the reality of what we have within our social security system, and the answers are therefore full powers, not split powers. I'm going to try and make some more progress. Neil Gray, Jackie Dunbar, Bob Doris and others did talk very rightly about the tale of two governments, and I think that was a point that was exceptionally strongly made. Emma Roddick also gave, I think, a very, very thoughtful contribution, talking about her own experiences of homelessness and the absolute necessity in us to tackle the drivers of poverty through this. People fall through the net, and that is absolutely unacceptable, and that's why we have to take a cross-government approach to be able to deal with this. And can I also just point out the contribution by Maggie Chapman? There weren't many contributions that did mention the work that's ongoing on human rights and the incorporation of the UN treaties. We have the opportunity within this parliamentary session to deliver something that is truly world-leading on this. And she mentioned the different parts of our society that will benefit from that. And I do hope that it is something that we will genuinely be able to take some progress on consensually. Yes.
Martin Whitefield.
I'm very grateful we choose exchange time to leap up. I wonder whether the Cabinet Secretary is able to answer the question that I posed with regard to the Supreme Court judgment that we anticipate within weeks.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm just coming to your contribution as well. Martin Whitfield make a contribution on the UNCRC, which is, of course, within the Supreme Court at the moment. So I won't take too much time or make too much commitment on a live case. But this government does remain absolutely committed to the incorporation of UNCRC to the maximum extent of the powers of this Parliament. And I hope that gives them some comfort in our words. Can I move on, Presiding Officer, to talk about some issues in education which hadn't came up, education, children and families, because this pandemic has had a significant impact on families and we need to make sure that we are delivering the support to them. That's exactly why a programme for government sets out a commitment to invest at least £50 million over the life of this Parliament to create a whole family wellbeing fund. We also absolutely have to take into account the talk of that promise that we all made to thousands of care experienced children and adults last year. We made a promise of transformational change in the care system, and we intend to absolutely keep that promise, and we will ensure that we will deliver on this despite the challenges. Yes.
Megan Kelleher.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. There is currently no streamlined approach towards adoption support for Scottish families despite the SNP's pledge of implementing the promise. Therefore, can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update regarding the care experience grants for 16 to 26-year-olds?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is again something that we are determined to move forward with. You've seen the programme for government, you've seen our commitment for that, and we are determined to deliver on that. If I can move on to education recovery, which again a number of members have mentioned, we are aware that there have been negative impacts on both the health and the well-being and attainment of some children and young people as a result of the pandemic, and that's exactly why there's been £450 million of additional funding that's already been committed as part of education recovery. A significant amount of work regarding educational renewal and recovery is already underway, and we'll continue to work with partners to ensure that pupils who have been negatively impacted are given the support they need to recover. And an important part of that is on the Scottish Attainment Challenge programme, and that does have an absolutely vital role. Now, Audit Scotland has recognised that there has been progress made on the poverty-related attainment gap, and head teachers have also reported back that they are seeing progress, but we know there is more to do. That's exactly why we've committed £215 million this year to the Attainment Scotland funding. including a £20 million pupil equity funding premium. And that's the first part of a £1 billion commitment to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap within this parliamentary term. I'm not sure how much time I have left.
The Cabinet Secretary is winding up.
I'm apparently winding up. My apologies, Miles Breggatt. I would have taken another intervention if I could. We are also determined to tackle teacher recruitment and to ensure that teachers have permanent contracts wherever possible, although, of course, recruitment and retention lies within the gift of local authorities. We've already committed £240 million to support local authorities for the appointment of an additional 2,200 teachers and more than 500 support staff in schools across Scotland, and we are providing further funding for councils to support the recruitment of 3,500 additional teachers and 500 classroom assistants over this parliamentary term. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, there is much within the programme for government that Ms Robertson and I could have discussed today within our own portfolios. There is an ambitious programme there to create that fairer Scotland. We have seen progress and we are proud of this government's record, and I think the results of the election have demonstrated that the Scottish people have put our trust in us once again to deliver on that. And I think we're beginning to repay that trust already. When you look at our first 100 days, we have demonstrated that we are committed to delivering on teacher recruitment, on levels to tackle anti-poverty. That's the type of delivery we're already seeing within the first 100 days, and that's the level of delivery we are committed to continuing to do over this parliamentary term. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on supporting a fairer and more equal society. It is now